for doom.
Ontogeny.
Tradum.
Ontogeny.
Mm-hmm.
I present to you the top 10 weirdest looking dinosaurs. I want to state the obvious and tell you that I'm going to be butchering the names of these dinosaurs.
Butchering the names of these dinosaurs.
Tradoon.
In 1856, the fossilized teeth of a small dinosaur were discovered in Montana. The species was aptly named Troodon, which means wounded teeth.
When evolution passed out the stealth gene, Troodons lucked out.
Tradoon.
This drawer contains almost all of the North American identified specimens of Troodon.
Troodon was every inch the predator, with razor-sharp serrated teeth and large, hook-like claws. Troodon probably fed on our ancestors, the early mammals. Troodon may have posed a greater threat to mammals than any other predator on Earth. The Troodon was suddenly cut down in its prime.
Tradoon.
Well, hello, everybody, and welcome back to Paleontologizing. It's really good to have you here today. Glad you could join me. We've got a very special stream today. As some of you probably know, I was away in the field for 2.5 months this summer. Away from the office, out digging up dinosaurs, and while we were doing that, and streaming live from the field, we weren't really talking about any of the new dinosaurs that were being published on while I was out there. Normally we cover new dinosaurs just pretty much as soon as they're published and from the office, but we've got a whole backlog of dinosaurs, 9 of them, in fact. 9 different dinosaurs that are brand new. We're going to be talking about each of those today and looking at the original scientific literature whenever we can. I've got, I think, 8 of the 9 descriptive papers. And I'm also trying out a new little, like, presentation software thing, so we'll see if everybody likes that, but that's going to be a ton of fun. And after today's broadcast, you will be all caught up on our new dinosaurs from summer 2023. So yeah, shiny new dinosaurs just for you and for all of us, ghostly ghoul. Hello, everybody. There's so many chat messages. I'm not going to go through each individually, but hello, everybody. And I'm so glad you could make it. And are you new here? Nauo, N4UO underscore? Welcome to Paleontologizing. If it's anybody's first time here, which it might be yours, welcome to Paleontologizing. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist, as you can probably guess looking at my office here. As a dinosaur paleontologist, I work on dinosaurs. Most paleontologists don't actually work on dinosaurs. It's kind of a unfortunate stereotype that that paleontologists study dinosaurs. Only a small fraction of us do, but I do. And I was out digging up dinosaurs for months this past summer, through June and July and August, and I finally just got back a little less than a week ago. And now we're back to our normal streams. Here we cover new publications in fossil science. I do all kinds of Q&A. We're going to start doing more interviews with other paleontologists. We do 3D modeling and 3D printing. In fact... Oh, come on. Give me a second. I'll try and get the 3D printer to show up here. There we go. Yeah. 3D printing a full-size Allosaurus skull right now. And we'll be assembling more of that in just a minute here, actually. Got some new pieces that just printed yesterday. Anyway, Paleontologizing, this channel, is all about showing you how paleontology works. Bringing fossil science to the people. So as a live, interactive broadcast, you can ask whatever questions you like, and I'll do my best to answer them. So if that sounds good to you, I hope you stick around. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. And, but yeah, let's see here. What is an Archaeopteryx? Now, oh, that is a good question. Yeah. Let me show you. This is an Archaeopteryx. What? This is the Berlin specimen of Archaeopteryx. This is my 3D print of the most famous Archaeopteryx specimen. It is just positively angelic, as I've said many times. Just absolutely gorgeous. It's a thing of beauty. Yeah, Archaeopteryx is, it's sometimes called a missing link between birds and dinosaurs. It's one of the reasons how we know that birds evolved from two-legged, feathered dinosaurs. And here is a lovely reconstruction of Archaeopteryx right here. It's basically like a little Velociraptor, but with more prominent wings than Velociraptor had. And Nuggy Neptune says, like an Animal Crossing. It probably is the same exact one as an Animal Crossing, isn't it? I think it's the same specimen. Well, close to this. Okay, that's interesting. They didn't use the actual specimen there, but they clearly borrowed from the Berlin specimen of Archaeopteryx in order to make this image. That's pretty funny, actually. There we go. Yeah. I wonder if they were afraid of, like, copyright infringement or something. Will Rounded, thank you for the follow, and welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. And here's the actual specimen right here. Yeah. Put an image in new tab. I guess that's as good as it gets. Reddit is all screwy like this. Huh. But anyway, yeah. Gorgeous, gorgeous specimen. So Archaeopteryx is basically like, think of it like an intermediate between non-bird dinosaurs and bird dinosaurs. That's not the worst reconstruction I've ever seen. It's kind of goofy looking, though. But, yeah, it's basically like a little Velociraptor. It's a pretty cool critter. It's from earlier than Velociraptor, significantly, because it's from the late Jurassic. But, yeah. Yeah. Is it a dinosaur, or is it a bird? Yes. It's both. All birds are dinosaurs, because birds evolved from a dinosaur ancestor. But Archaeopteryx is particularly dinosaur-y because it's right near the ancestry of all birds. A lot of paleontologists don't think any longer that it actually is at the very base of the bird family tree. It might be like an off-branch that didn't lead directly to birds, but it's part of this very birdy milieu of Mesozoic theropods. It's like on the way to birds, if that makes sense. Yeah. So yeah. But is it like that birds evolved, dinosaurs evolved in birds? Absolutely. Now, yes. 1,000,000% yes. And this is not just me saying this. Talk to any paleontologist, talk to any ornithologist, bird scientist, talk to any evolutionary biologist, they'll all tell you the same thing. Birds evolved from dinosaurs. In fact, let's see. See if I can find you a decent video on this real quick. Here we go, take a look at this.
When an asteroid slammed into Earth 66 million years ago, only about 20% of all animal species survived.
Yeah, possibly less, actually.
What happened to these lucky few?
There we go.
Birdie Milieu.
I like that caravan, yeah.
It started millions of years before the asteroid strike with a dinosaur family called theropods.
Yeah, that's kind of a goofy looking one, but yeah. Theropods, just like I was telling you about. So some dinosaurs are birds? Absolutely, Mr. Broccoli. Absolutely. In fact, today, all living dinosaurs are birds. Birds are the only group of dinosaurs that survived that extinction event at the end of the Cretaceous when that asteroid hit. Birds are the only dinosaurs that survived. All the other dinosaurs went extinct. Although today we've got something like, I think there's, what, how many species of bird that are around today? I believe it's over 9,000. Yeah, we've got a fair number of at least 12. Yeah, there you go, Orionothalia. yeah. We've got,
Vegeta, our...
Yeah.
It's
how many?
9,000!
Old meme. Anyway, we've got over 9,000 species of living bird today, which birds actually outnumber mammal species like 2-to-1. So people call this the age of mammals that we're living in nowadays, but you could really make a strong argument that we're still living in the age of dinosaurs, because dinosaurs today outnumber mammal species 2-to-1. So yeah, yeah. Oh, and paper's going well. Very nice, Hugin. Cool. That's awesome, Hugin. Cool. Thank you, Claire, for reposting that. Anyway, yeah, over 9,000, Barn Jeff.
The theropod family featured reptilian specimens, some of which had bird-like traits, including feathers and three-toed feet.
Yep.
A distant cousin of theropods and today's birds was the Archaeopteryx.
Oh, here we go.
Fossils from Germany date the animal to about 150 million yep. years ago, and they show how the animal may have even had both reptilian and avian traits. Many ancient birds...
Nimbus Flow, thank you for that follow. I appreciate that. Welcome, welcome. And Tudor the Terrible says there's a dinosaur in my garden right now. There's probably a dinosaur in most people's gardens right now. Yes, absolutely. Isn't that cool?
Birds would also exhibit yeah. this mishmash.
It's the same specimen.
But eventually, yeah. some of these avian dinosaurs evolved to have more recognizably bird-like characteristics. One example is the sparrow-sized Cynornis sentensis.
Yeah, Cynornis.
Discovered in China around 1990.
Cool critter.
The archaic creature is considered one of the first birds capable of flight. In 1992, a new specimen was discovered in Antarctica.
The Javis.
Called Vegavis II.
Yeah.
A 67 million year old creature may have looked like a duck and sounded like one. The fossil included a vocal organ called a syrinx, which is only found in today's quacking waterfowl. About a million years after the time of Vegavis II, the asteroid struck Earth and redirected the evolutionary paths of many animals, including birds.
Redirected the evolutionary paths of many animals. So really what they mean here, it just created a tremendous bottleneck where like very few species survived and a bunch of groups went completely extinct. So yeah, it redirected the path of evolution on Earth. But, like, for saying it redirected the paths of certain groups of animals, I mean, first of all, it wiped out other groups. So, I don't know, it's just a weird way to put it, I suppose. How did she say it exactly?
Redirected the evolutionary paths of many animals.
Yeah, it also ended the evolutionary paths of many animals, too, by driving them into extinction. But, yeah.
Including birds.
I'm nitpicking here. On tone.
Three bird groups of the theropod family managed to make it through such a cat...
And Ken says, Paleo Media just loves that impact event. It does, doesn't it? Holy cow. To this day, I have a fear of asteroids. Ken, I think I know where you're coming from there. Yeah.
Cataclysmic event. And scientists are still uncertain as to how.
Let me take a look at that in a minute, Smurf, when this is
over. Birds have been able to adapt and evolve, eventually blooming into the over 10,000 species alive today.
There we go.
So the next time you're looking out at your bird feeder, remember that you're looking at the modern-day dinosaurs.
It's true. Yeah. This is based on many, many lines of evidence that we have nowadays. So, Yeah, I'm gonna adjust my lighting here a little bit. That's too bright. That's better. Excellent. Yeah. And Nuggy Neptune says primates farm dinosaurs. Oh, I thought that said primates from dinosaurs, and I was gonna go, no, primates are mammals. They didn't evolve from dinosaurs. But primates farm dinosaurs. It's true, Nuggy Neptune. It's weird to think about, but yeah. Yeah, chickens and ducks and geese and quails and ostriches and emus and other farmable birds. Either domesticated or tamed or held in captivity. Yeah. Yeah. Pretty wild, right? Anyway, let's look at Smorf's piece of art here. Sorry, I missed this yesterday, Smorf. It was crazy. Oh, very nice. We've got a Carnotaurus stopping and smelling the flowers. Carnotaurus would have been able to do that because this animal, existed at the end of the Cretaceous, after the evolution of primitive flowers. So these two would have coexisted. I don't know if there were purple flowers back then, but maybe. I don't know if we have a good understanding of what color flowers existed at different times in Earth history. But very nice, Smurf. Very nice. I like that. Yeah. And it looks like we've got an ad here. So everybody who's watching right now and not having to watch the ad. Well, we're having some secret time, aren't we? Good stuff. Yeah. And Beats International says... saying redirecting makes it sound like they were somehow destined to evolve down some other route had it not been for the asteroid. I mean, most of these species would have continued evolving if they hadn't gone extinct. Yeah, the non-avian dinosaurs, there's no reason to think that they were in the decline or anything like that. They probably would have been going for another few hundred million years if it weren't for that asteroid. It was those therapsids, the mammals, that got really lucky. And Kodali, thank you for reposting that from Renfield. I'll maybe answer that question in 37 seconds when the ad's done, because it looks like they might be caught behind an ad. Is a crocodile not a dinosaur? We'll talk about that in a minute. Yeah. But sharks are very old. And Barnjeff says, so ornithology equals dinothology? I mean, in a sense, yeah. Like, cetology, the study of whales, is a subset of mammalogy, the study of mammals, which is a subset of zoology, the study of animals. And what could this possibly be? Jody Fish. Holy moly, thank you for those 5 gift subs there. I appreciate that tremendously. Thank you, thank you.
Ukulele with those 5 gift subs.
Good stuff, Jody Fish. Thank you. Thank you for that. Excellent. Thanks to you, there's now 5 people who won't have to watch any more ads for the next month. That's great. That's excellent. Now, we had a question about why isn't a crocodile a dinosaur or a shark? Because sharks are much older than dinosaurs. Let me show you why. There we go. This is a really simplified graphic talking about what is a dinosaur and what isn't. So this is a really simple, what we call a phylogeny, an evolutionary family tree. And so the way that we as scientists classify living things is based on their ancestry.
Of life, it's very quirky, fortuitous,
Panda Kaizen
character. We are literally here only because of the good fortune of dinosaur extinction.
That's true. Absolutely. Thank you for those 7 months, Panakaizen. Thanks for helping me avoid extinction myself. Anyway, like we say, dinosaurs never truly went extinct because we still have birds. And on this chart, everything with a little leaf on it means that's a group that's still alive. All the rest of these groups are extinct. So the bird branch of the dinosaur family tree, they're still around. Anyway, we classify living things based on what they're actually related to phylogenetically, you know, ancestrally, evolutionarily. And so on this chart, dinosaurs are everything from this point on. So if there's a branch coming off of this, that is a dinosaur. In order to be a dinosaur, you have to have evolved from that one dinosaur ancestor. So crocodiles are over here. They're kind of close to dinosaurs. They're still a member of Archosauria, but they don't come from that dinosaur ancestor. So they're not dinosaurs. Same with marine reptiles over here. Or same with mammals, like these guys. They didn't evolve from that dinosaur ancestor, so they're not dinosaurs. Does that make sense? Yeah.
An anonymous gifter really wants ukulele with those 5 gift subs.
Thank you, anonymous gifter. Really? That is tremendous. I really appreciate it.
An anonymous user gifted a tier 1 sub to JR30.
And thank you, anonymous gifter, again. Really? That's beautiful. No, it really is. Thank you, thank you.
An anonymous user gifted a tier 1 sub to Sugar.
And Nuggy Neptune says, are birds technically classified as dinosaurs now? 100%, yes.
An anonymous user gifted a tier 1 sub.
So let's look at another phylogeny.
Really spectacular. Spared no expense.
Here's one of theropod dinosaurs. And birds are right there. So birds are part of the dinosaur family tree.
Really spectacular. Spared no expense.
And again, don't just take my word for it. Man, Twitch is really wigging out with the anonymous gifts there. That should have been all 5 in one alert, but it split it up. And thank you, Marika937, for the follow. I really appreciate that. Thank you, thank you. Let's just look up birds on Wikipedia. So you can tell I'm not making this up. This is the general consensus now, that birds are a kind of dinosaur. So birds are a group of warm-blooded vertebrates constituting the class Aves. Remember, there's some things that birds have. Birds are feathered theropod dinosaurs and constitute the only known living dinosaurs. And if you click this link, it takes you to the origin of birds there. Yeah. So, and there's our Archaeopteryx again, just like right here on the shelf. Yeah. So yeah, indeed, birds are living dinosaurs. If you want to read more about this, there's the Wikipedia article. Yeah. And SG Rock says, I thought all dinosaurs were cold-blooded? No.
More protection? He simply grew spears which projected from his body armor.
And Tudor the Terrible, thank you for that follow. I appreciate it very much. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. Most dinosaurs were warm-blooded. I know a lot of people think, maybe because what they were taught in school a long time ago, like, oh, dinosaurs are reptiles, and reptiles are sluggish and cold-blooded and not very intelligent and antisocial and just all these other reptilian traits. But the thing is, birds are dinosaurs, and birds are warm-blooded, active, intelligent, social, you know, clever, brightly colored, dynamic animals. And if birds evolved from dinosaurs, then that gives us some clues as to what dinosaurs would have been like in life. So if you start to think about dinosaurs as being more bird-like than, like, classically reptilian, then, well, yeah, you know, this is not a particularly colorful bird, but listen to how excited this bird is getting for all those gift subs. A little too excited, maybe. Uh-oh.
Get out of there, it's gonna blow!
Executive Storm is overloading the system with 10 gift subs.
Executive Storm, thank you for that. That is extraordinary, and I really appreciate it. Thank you. Holy moly. Fantastic. Yeah.
Protect our fossils, because if they're removed, America loses them forever.
Marika937, thank you for that Prime sub. That is extraordinary. Thank you for the support. That means a lot to me. And holy cow, Executive Storm, 10 gift subs there.
Let's protect our fossils, because if they're removed, America loses.
And Mist Evil,
forever.
Thank you for converting from a Prime sub to a Tier 1 sub, a recurring one. That is splendid, and I appreciate it.
1,000 bits can make
wonderful.
A wonderful difference in promoting the appreciation and understanding of fossil science here on Twitch.
Mist Evil, thank you for those 1,000 bits. Holy cow, I really appreciate that. That's good stuff. Holy cow. Yeah. Excellent. That's extraordinary. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah, holy moly. Anyway, when you're thinking about dinosaurs, don't think of, like, lizards or turtles or crocodiles. Think about birds as, like, your main source of inspiration, your main frame of reference there. Birds like this beautiful one right here.
Really wants ukulele with those 5 gift subs.
Mist, thank you for those 5 gift subs. That is extraordinary. And Murph. Thank you, Murph. There we go. Really appreciate that, Murph. Holy cow. Yeah, level 5 complete. Excellent. That is extraordinary. Look, we are already 35 sixtieths. What would that be? 7 tenths? No. If 35 is 5 times 7, we're 7 twelfths of the way to our sub goal. There you go. Beautiful. Yeah. And Reganation, thank you for that gift sub to Arila Thalia. Really appreciate that too. Beautiful. Thank you, Reganation. That's brilliant. Yeah. And we need some ukulele? We'll have some ukulele, I think. We're gonna be,
fewer than 40 full-time dinosaur paleontologists.
Lordy! That is beautiful, and I really appreciate it.
3 of them are leading this expedition.
That's extraordinary. There used to be fewer than 40 full-time dinosaur paleontologists in the whole world. Now there's probably 5 times that. And I'm very fortunate to be able to call myself that.
But I'm turning into...
What?
A dinosaur.
I just stumbled about this channel and I like what you're doing, so I might check it out more in the future, Kappa.
Res, thank you for just stumbling upon this channel 26 months ago and having been a supporter ever since, and I appreciate that, Res. Thank you. It's extraordinary. It really is. So yeah. Excellent. We probably will do a few ukulele songs, given that this is early in the stream. And thank you, Tommy Plotticus, for that gift sub. Beautiful. And thank you, Mist, for the 200 bits. Extraordinary. For those of you who are fairly new here, we used to have it so that every level 5 hype train, I would play some ukulele songs as a thank you. But we've been having a lot of those lately, and I think maybe once we reach the sub goal, that'll be a great time for ukulele songs in the future. But I'm just announcing this now, so we'll just do ukulele songs today. Get that we reached a level 5. But thank you, Draku777, for those gift subs there. Extraordinary, and I really appreciate it. Thank you. Holy cow.
Really spectacular, spared no expense.
And Haraz
gifted a tier 1 sub to Bokun004.
That is excellent. It really is.
Harsh gifted a tier 1 sub to 0Pulses, 0Excuse not to dance.
Good stuff. Yeah. Holy moly, this is extraordinary. Well, Athena Queenie, thank you for following. Thank you, Christasticus, for the gift sub there. And thank you, Haraz, for those 5 gift subs. Thank you, Oscar Juniors, for that gift sub.
Really spectacular. Spared no expense.
And
Oscar JRS gifted Oscar a Juniors. Tier 1 sub to Big_Mistakey.
Oscar Juniors, thank you for gifting Big O Mistakey. What was it? Mistakey, I'm glad you got a gift sub. This is extraordinary generosity, everybody, and I really, really appreciate it. That's excellent stuff. And we're just six away, holy cow, from meeting our sub goal for the day? Fantastic. That's extraordinary. It really is. Holy cow. And there's six of them right there from Norby. Norby, thank you so much. Really appreciate that, Norby. Holy moly. We've reached our sub goal. Thank you, everybody, for that incredible support. This is the only reason that I can do this full-time, is because of the generous support of this community. This has become my full-time job here over the past year and a half, and I'm so lucky to be able to do this, so thank you for that, everybody. Holy cow. Yeah. But yeah, and Athena Queenie says, I heard about you twice in one day a few days ago, so I knew I had to follow. Athena, where did you hear about me? I'm intrigued. If you wouldn't mind, sharing, I would love to know about that. If anybody here is new, and they'd like to share how they heard about this channel, that would be useful information for me. So don't be shy about that. Holy cow. That's extraordinary. I'm gonna get out the old ukulele and we're gonna play some songs. But tell me how you found out about the channel, if you don't mind. And Pipper Papper, shoot, we were just talking about that yesterday. There's a few different generally accepted evolutionary purposes for feathers prior to flight. Insulation, display, like thermoregulation, and also aerodynamics. You don't have to fly in order for wings to actually be useful. You can use rudimentary wings to help you run up steep inclines, or to help you flap to stay on top of your prey if you're a sort of animal that eats other critters and immobilizes them by standing on them, like modern birds of prey do. So yeah, yeah. MLS says, recommended stream from Twitch. That's nice. Excellent. Oh, and we're not supposed to be in traveling outdoors. Shoot, let me change that, Alex. Or Claire, if you're watching, if you wouldn't mind switching us to science and technology category. That slipped my mind earlier. Yeah. There we go. Nuggy Neptune. Oh, educational tag. That's awesome. Yeah. And Ada Smith, or Ada Smib. Ada Smib, welcome. Now, we know 1,000,000% that dinosaurs had feathers. We've got... here. There we go. Feather dinosaurs. I mean, there's Wikipedia. I could show you some videos and stuff. But we've got something like 60 species of dinosaur that are now known to have had feathers. Here's a chart showing different dinosaur groups and whether they had scaly skin or they had feathers. The ones that look like little bubbles or eggs, those are groups that had scaly skin based on preserved fossilized skin. And the ones that have the three different kinds of feathers, either plumaceous feathers or like simpler kind of like simple branched feathers or little barbs, what we call proto feathers. That's yellow, blue, and red, respectively. Yeah, those are different groups of dinosaur that we actually have fossilized feathers on. So yeah, yeah. And Ada Smith, no, there's, yeah, shoot. Let's maybe watch a little video about this before we do ukulele, shall we? Mustang says, hello from Pakistan. Sorry, I'm all over the place right now, but, hello from the beautiful San Francisco Bay Area. I'm gonna pull up this video. I hope things are good for you over there in Pakistan. And, good to have you. Let's see. Here's a neat little video.
Jurassic Park first came out in 1983, it was a pretty groundbreaking depiction of dinosaurs.
We've watched this video I don't know how many times on this channel.
Plenty of artistic liberties. But overall, the movie was so much better than what had come before in terms of recreating what scientists knew about how dinosaurs looked and how they moved. The character Alan Grant was actually a bit ahead of his time.
Look at the half moon shaped bones on the wrist. There's no way these guys learn how to fly. No, seriously.
Back then, the claim that birds evolved from dinosaurs was still controversial. Now it's widely accepted. But in the late 1990s, the consensus science started speeding ahead, and the movies just didn't keep up. Even the latest installment, Jurassic World, shot in ultra-high definition 3D, it features dinosaurs.
Let's protect our fossils, because if they're
thank you, Mustang.
America loses them forever.
I appreciate that follow. Thank you, thank you. Yeah. Anyway.
The science started speeding ahead, and the movies just didn't keep up. Even the latest Jurassic World shot in ultra-high definition 3D, it features dinosaurs that are out of date.
Way out of date. Like, 20 years out of date. It's kind of nuts.
3 years after the first Jurassic Park movie was released, scientists in China uncovered a feathered dinosaur for the first time. Cynosauropteryx.
Yep.
It takes very specific conditions for the Earth to record.
We did actually have a few feathered dinosaurs before this that don't get mentioned very often, but they were kind of mysterious. Like, there was a critter called Avimimus that was discovered, I think, back in the 60s or 70s. I think the Soviets may have published on it. But we've known about this animal for a long time, Avimimus, and we were pretty certain that that animal had feathers, but it wasn't super clear what group of dinosaurs it belonged to. I think it's, there we go. That's right here in this lovely book. There we go. This is in Dave Norman's Dinosaur Encyclopedia, Illustrated Encyclopedia of Dinosaurs. This is a book from the 80s. Written in like the latest 70s, I think. But there's Avimimus right there, which the name means bird mimic. And so there was a general idea that this animal had feathers on its body. And, let's see. Kurzanov, who described it, believed that the bones of the animal, the arm in particular, show traces equivalent to the feather attachment areas of the wing bones of birds, provoking the idea that maybe several theropods were feathered, rather like birds. So this has been an idea for a long time, and we kind of knew about that for a long time. There is an illustration of the arm bone of Avimimus, and that seems to have had quill knobs on it, or at least like a crest to support feathers. Nowadays we recognize this animal was fully feathered, just like a bird. So anyway, this has been an idea for a long time, but it wasn't really until the mid-1990s that we had incontrovertible proof that dinosaurs had feathers. Like, actual fossilized feathers on a dinosaur skeleton. Here we go.
The Park movie was released, scientists in China uncovered a feathered dinosaur for the first time. Cynosauropteryx.
Yeah.
It takes very specific conditions for the Earth to record soft tissues like these primitive feathers. The animals had to be buried quickly before decomposing, and in fine-grained sediment. It turned out that this part of China, Liaoning Province, saw major volcanic eruptions around 120 million years ago, which provided these very conditions. And more than 30 feathered dinosaur species have been unearthed there and in some other places since 1996.
Yep, now it's closer to 60.
Dinosaurs were mostly two-legged meat eaters, part of a group that's closely related to birds in the dinosaur family tree. That group includes many of the dinosaurs featured in the Jurassic Park movies.
Gallimimus.
These guys probably had feathers of some sort for insulation or decoration.
Yep.
And that includes the raptors. Jurassic Park 3 sort of nodded to the new research by giving them a little bit of a hairdo, but their feathers probably looked more like this.
That's not terrible. There's much better, like, feathered velociraptor illustrations.
From the Gobi Desert revealed bumps on the forearm, similar to the wing attachments on modern birds. That means the raptors had wings.
Oh, that's a terrible illustration. So, Velociraptor would have looked a lot more like this little model that I showed yesterday. This guy right here. That's actually a pretty decent representation of a feathered Velociraptor. And I'm actually working on my own feathered velociraptor representation, and I'm hoping I can show that off to everybody very soon when it's done, in hopefully less than a month's time.
And what about T-Rex? There's no direct evidence, but a few years ago, scientists found a 30-foot dinosaur with some feathers, the biggest yet so far.
Yeah.
The Tyrannus is thought to be closely related to T-Rex, so it's possible that the most famous and feared dinosaur might have been sort of fluffy. It's not clear how universal feathers were among dinosaurs, but while most of the specimens are theropods, there have been a few interesting findings from way over on the other side of the family tree. These two have bristles of some sort.
Which, I don't know, those of you who were here during our fieldwork streams might remember Jim Kirkland talking about how he doesn't think that this is legit. These bristles on this Atacosaurus specimen. He says that he has seen like 100 of these, 100 Cetacosaurs preserved with skin in China. None of them have this except for this one specimen that was stolen from China and is now somewhere in Europe. I think it's either in Italy or Germany, but it was smuggled illegally out of the country. And there have been all these publications on it. That's the one with the preserved butthole, the cloaca. And yeah, all this preserved skin and everything. There's some shady stuff going on with this specimen, it seems like. But Jim is not convinced that these are bristles that belong on the animal. He thinks that this is just some plant material that's there on the fossil, because you also get plants preserved in the same environment. So time will tell whether this is legit or not. But, oh, and it's in Germany. Okay. Anyway, it was basically stolen from China, this one specimen. So yeah, Jim doesn't think that the bristles are real. The butt fuzz, he calls it. But yeah, yeah. It wasn't you? I'm glad to hear it, Taper. No, it was the illegal fossil trade. But anyhow.
And it's therefore likely that we're here today because, by the luck of the draw, dinosaurs who had been dominant over mammals in ordinary times got felled in a mass extinction.
It's true, Jump Jess. Thank you for the 11 months of support. That is extraordinary. But yeah, we absolutely get dinosaurs preserved with skin on them, or feathers, or sometimes like the actual keratin on the claws and stuff like that, or the beak gets preserved. Most of the time, dinosaur fossils are relatively fragmentary. You don't have the whole animal preserved, let alone things like soft tissue. But sometimes you get really, really lucky if the preservational environment is right. Like they were showing earlier in this. Where is that? Right here? Yeah.
This part of China, Liaoning.
There we go.
Cynosauropteryx. It takes very specific
conditions.
To record soft tissues like these primitive feathers. The animals had to be buried quickly before decomposing. And fine-grained sediment.
Yeah.
It turned out that this part of China, Liaoning province, saw major volcanic eruptions around 120 million years ago, which provided these very conditions.
So those conditions include really, really fine-grained sediment.
Here's something stranger than science fiction.
Grungy Sheriff, historic fact. Thank you for that follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. Really, really fine-grained sediment. Like volcanic ash can be incredibly fine because it's basically like microscopic bits of glass. You know, like obsidian is a, you know, that's volcanic in origin, and that's volcanic glass. Think about some volcanic ash being like obsidian that's just ground down to a fine powder. It won't be specifically obsidian, but we're using an analogy here. Think about it that way, like microscopic glass dust. And that's a beautiful kind of preservational medium to get stuff like preserved skin or feathers, like on this Cetacosaurus specimen, where it does have preserved skin. And even a preserved cloaca, the butthole of the animal. But it may have also preserved plants, and that might be what this is, like just kind of behind the tail. Anyway, yeah. Will Rounded says, what if I was going to ask to be made into a fossil when I die? I'll show you another video after this really, really quick, and then maybe we'll do some ukulele.
Which may or may not be related to bird feathers.
Yeah.
And this one, found last year, has even more complex feather-like filaments.
Yeah, Coolidodromius.
These may indicate that feather precursors date back to some of the dinosaurs' earliest common ancestors. Jurassic World could have introduced feathered dinosaurs to a huge audience this year.
Oh, it would have been so great if they had.
But it didn't.
This is the thing, is that, like, when people ask me in chat, like, oh, did dinosaurs actually have feathers? If Jurassic World had just kept up with modern paleontology and had actually featured feathers on the dinosaurs that should have feathers, like its Velociraptor, then, you know, everybody would know this just through kind of cultural osmosis, you know? But I don't know. They decided to make a cut-rate fan film, basically, than actually do anything original and groundbreaking and interesting like the original Jurassic Park did. You know, the whole thing was just a cash grab, and yeah.
According to Jack Horner, a paleontologist that worked on all four films, the decision was made for the sake of consistency.
Which, Jack wanted to have feathers on the Velociraptors back in 1993, and Spielberg told him no. So I think, I don't know.
I think you should enjoy science as much as you can, and you can't enjoy science alone. You have to share it.
That's true, Sammy Kin, and thank you, Sammy Kin, for helping all of us enjoy science together through your support for the past 3 months. Appreciate it. But yeah. And the Jurassic Park Velociraptor wasn't a Velociraptor. That's correct, Javasaurus. It's actually Deinonychus. But yeah.
But you have to assume that they also just weren't up for the task of making feathers into something scary.
Feathers can be darn scary. Shoot. Yeah, they could be really, really scary.
Let's protect our fossils, because if they're removed, America loses them forever.
And Tapir, thank you for converting that Prime sub into a recurring sub. I appreciate that tremendously. Thank you, Tapir. That is beautiful. That means you won't have to worry about any ads for the next... as long as you stay subscribed.
Dinosaurs hold a special magnetism for children.
The California Burbs...
16 months of dinosaur feathers.
That's 16 months from you. Thank you so much for, helping support me for the past 16 months. Holy cow, California Burbs. And if anybody's not yet following California Burbs, you're missing out. We're not doing Thursday Birds Day today, California Burbs, but next Thursday we will. Anyway, I hope the birds have been doing well on your stream, and I hope they've been enjoying all the food you've been giving them. Anybody, if you're not yet following California Burbs, you're missing out. It's live bird watching right here on Twitch. Very cool stuff. Yeah. And feathers can be very scary if you've ever seen a Canada goose. Absolutely. Yeah. Trying to find this in a... Yeah, there we go. We could have had designs like this for the dromaeosaurs, the Velociraptor, in Jurassic World. But, we didn't get that. That would have been far more interesting, you know? Any of these would have been far more interesting than the scaly monstrosities that we got. These are so much cooler, and they actually comport with the science that we have, with the actual fossils. But yeah. Anyway, yeah. We had a question about how does one become a fossil? And so without further ado, here is a guide, step by step, on how to become a fossil. Take a look.
Here's a step by step guide to becoming a fossil. Step 1, die. Once you are dead, your remains may be scavenged by other organisms.
Yep.
Step 2, get buried fast. If you are buried rapidly, your remains won't completely decay or be carried away by scavengers.
I wish that were you.
Your best bet for rapid burial is to die near or in a river, lake, or ocean, where water can deposit sediment over you. Step 3. Soak in groundwater for a long, long time.
Yeah.
Groundwater contains minerals. Over time, dissolved mineral...
Oh! Here's something stranger. Rampo, thanks for that follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Holy cow. Global
and serious game of paleontology.
And Katerini, thank you for the follow also. Welcome to the channel. I'm glad you could make it. And Meow House says, How to Fossilize Your Hamster is an excellent book with a chapter on how to do that. Really?
A ponderous trachodon, 32 feet long and 14 feet high.
I'm going to have to check that out.
1,500 teeth and not a single cavity.
Dying in chat, thanks for following. I hope you are safe and well right now, dying in chat. Your name is very dire. Thanks for clicking that follow button. Here. How to fossilize your hamster? And Diluit, thank you for gifting Rampo. That is brilliant. And thank you to Juff's One Cup. Thanks for the one follow there, among many. I appreciate it, and welcome to the channel. It's great to have you here. Holy cow, how'd you find out about this crazy mess here?
Are you a fan of dinosaurs?
Are you?
I won't get angry if you aren't. What?
Weedum S, thank you for the follow, Weedums. It's good to have you here. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. My GF, Diluta, recommended you. Well, thank you, Diluta. I appreciate that. Yeah. Yeah. Well, well, well. How to fossilize your hamster. It's a catchy title, isn't it? Somewhere between that and the full-page advertisement in The New Scientist, I was persuaded to buy the book, How to Fossilize Your Hamster. Book. Cool. Well, I'd never heard of this before, but that sounds pretty neat. Yeah. Other experiments for the armchair scientist? That's pretty cool. I like that. Well, here, let's go back to our step-by-step guide on how to become a fossil, because by now, many of you have probably forgotten step one already. And Two Jeffs, One Cup says, came across your stream on the Twitch recommended section. Excellent. My grandma would read me dinosaur books as a baby. Well, get ready to have your love affair with dinosaurs rekindled. Welcome, Two Jeffs. It is great to have you here. Shoot, for everybody who just stumbled in, let me to introduce myself real quick. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. And here on Twitch, I do science outreach full time. I just got back from the field where I was digging up dinosaurs in Wyoming and then in Utah, in June and then July and then the beginning of August. Now I'm back here in my office and we're talking fossil science. If you've got any questions, you're in the right place. Stick around. Yeah. And here's your step-by-step guide.
Here's a step-by-step guide to becoming a fossil.
Yeah.
Step one. Die. Once you are dead, your remains may be scavenged by other organisms. Step 2. Get buried fast.
Yeah.
If you are buried rapidly, your remains won't completely decay or be carried away by scavengers. Your best bet for rapid burial is to die near or in a river, lake, or ocean, where water can deposit sediment over you.
Yep. That's the whole thing. That sediment deposition is absolutely critical. You will not become a fossil if you are not embedded in sediment. Fossils, we find them in the rocks. It's the only place that we find fossils. Unless they've already been dug up and you find them in a museum or a rock shop or something. You know what I mean. So, critical. You got to put yourself in a depositional environment. And so, if you want to fossilize a hamster, for instance, hopefully, you know, the hamster has already agreed to this and has died of natural causes after a full and beautiful life. Take that hamster and, you know, toss it into a bayou or an alluvial fan or, you know, a swamp or someplace like that where you've got accommodational space, we call it in sequence stratigraphy, where you can have sediment pour in and cover it and bury it. That is critically important to have this.
Or ocean, where water can deposit sediment over you.
There we go.
Step
yeah.
Three, soak in groundwater for a long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
Groundwater contains minerals. Over time,
there you go, Thalo.
Dissolved minerals can harden after filling in cavities in your skeleton.
Let's protect our fossils, because if they're removed, America loses them forever.
Hamster Overdrive, thank you for that Prime sub. I appreciate that very much. And, well, shoot, are you ready to become a fossil? Maybe step negative one is lead a full and happy life first before you die and then get buried and all the rest of the steps. But thank you, Hamster Overdrive, for that that support. I really appreciate it. Welcome.
The water can dissolve your skeleton, leaving only minerals in its place. Either way, your skeleton will turn to stone, and you'll be a fossil.
There you go. Yeah.
Step four, wait to be exposed. As the years go by, if you're lucky, sea levels can fall a lot.
Curtis Flush, thank you for the follow, and welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Thanks for dropping in there.
Can erode and expose you. Then, if your luck holds out, you might get spotted by a fossil hunter.
Yeah.
And wind up in a museum collection where scientists can study you to learn about evolution.
There you go. Yeah. Good stuff. So that's how you become a fossil. It really is like a one in a million shot, but our planet has been here for a long time, and life has existed on it for a couple billion years at this point. And so one in a million shots, even if they're rare, they happen often enough over the vast expanse of time that we've got a lot of fossils. So yeah. Yeah. Oh, and Claire Burr, thank you for reposting that from Rucola Raider. Did the bad reputation of Soviet zoology after Lysenkoism affect people's trust in that specimen, Sinoceropteryx? No, I mean, Sinoceropteryx was a long time after Lysenko. So I'd say no. Unless Rocco Lareder was talking about Ava Mimas, but not really. Lysenko was under Stalin, I think, right? It was like the 1950s, you know? So I don't think that would have affected things much, no. But good question. Yeah. Oh, you meant Ava Mimas. Okay, cool. Yeah, no worries. Yeah, good stuff. The Soviet-Mongolian expeditions were actually really interesting. I wonder if, if we have any video footage of that. Probably not, actually. Yeah. Huh. But yeah, let's get rid of some of these tabs. And,
what you doing?
In just a few minutes, we're gonna be assembling some pieces of our 3D printed Allosaurus skull before we get into our new dinosaurs that were just described in the last few months.
Dinosaur?
Zhangers, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Did you unfollow by mistake or something? But yeah, yeah. Oh, Lyle Paradise wants to know, how old is the oldest identified fossil to date? I think it's like 3 billion years old, Lyle Paradise. Well, let's look that up real quick.
Here's a step-by-step guide to becoming a fossil. Step one, die.
Nell, thank you for the 14 months, and thank you for helping me avoid step one there for that long. At a tier two, no less. Thank you so much, Nell. I appreciate you. Thank you. Yeah, there we go. This is from the UCMP website, actually. This is the museum where I got my start in Berkeley, California, back in high school. The oldest known fossils, in fact, are cyanobacteria from Archean rocks of Western Australia, dated 3.5 billion years old. That's really, really old. Holy cow. This may be somewhat surprising since the oldest rocks are only a little older, 3.8 billion. Yeah. So, yeah, that's the oldest rocks that we have on Earth's surface today that we can explore. But the Earth itself is about 4.5 billion years old. But rocks get recycled. You know about the rock cycle, right? So it's really... We don't have any of those original rocks, I don't think. Anyway. Yeah. And which dinosaur could have been domesticated the easiest? Ask the hangers. Let me show you, hanger. I think I can find a video of this dinosaur. Here we go. Well, this dinosaur might actually be misidentified in the video. But, it still gives you a fairly good idea of what it is. Here we go. Chickens are one of the first dinosaurs to be domesticated, along with pigeons also. Pigeons might actually be the earliest domesticated bird, even before chickens, I think. But anyway, we know that today that birds are dinosaurs. And so chickens, geese, ducks, turkeys, they're all domesticated dinosaurs. But there were a lot of other, you know, if we're talking about Mesozoic dinosaurs in particular, then, yeah, there's no reason to think that a lot of them wouldn't have been easy to domesticate, too, if they were still around today. Yeah. Domestication is kind of a funny thing where, yeah, that's Tianyu Long right there, if I remember correctly. Little feathered dinosaur. I'm not saying that feathered dinosaurs would have been easier to domesticate. I mean, shoot. Animals like Utah Raptor might have been much trickier. You know? Trying to domesticate this polar bear-sized, you know, extremely fast, intelligent, winged, feathered dinosaur. Like, I wouldn't... Yeah, wouldn't necessarily put my money on that. That's a pretty nice one, too. I like that a lot. But yeah, I don't know. Domestication's a funny thing where, like, certain animals can be very similar to one another, two different species, and one is domesticable and one is not. Think about, like, horses and zebras. Horses were domesticated by human beings a long time ago. Zebras... People have tried again and again and again to domesticate zebras, and it never works. And it's because, well, a number of things. They don't have the right kind of, like, social structure to, like, put up with being domesticated. They tend to be much more, like, anarchistic than horses are. They also, a horse will bite, but it'll let go. Zebras will bite and just latch onto you until they, like, take out a huge chunk of your flesh. They're just ill-tempered animals. And that sort of temperament is not something that fossilizes well. He'll tell you that in nature. Thank you, Target TGG, for the follow. So yeah, what makes a certain animal domesticable and another one not? Yeah. Yeah. Here, maybe let's take a look at a video like this. Let's see if this is any good.
There's
I haven't seen this before.
The domestication of plants and animals has had a huge impact on our lives.
Sure.
Without it, we would probably still be living the hunter-gatherer lifestyle today. The domestication of animals has provided us with food, transport, clothes, just hunting.
Just ask this scientician. He'll tell you that in nature.
He will tell you. Ask him about all this stuff. Duke Ferdinand, thank you for the follow and welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. Don't ride in any, you know, open air vehicles on any parade routes anytime soon, you know? It's good to have you here in chat. Thank you for following. And Hamster Overdrive says, I love to see when you were out on your dig site. Love this too, when you inform us and correct misinfo that's out there. Do you have any more digging plans? Not until next summer, it looks like. There might be something that pops up here and there, but it looks like it'll be next summer when I'm out digging again.
No reason to think dinosaurs wouldn't still be here, still be dominating the Earth.
And Kathy C212, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome.
Companions, fertilizer, as well as friendly companions. But have you ever wondered why we've only been able to domesticate some animals and not others?
Yeah,
why don't we have pet pandas or ride zebras instead of horses? And how does domestication change an animal?
It's a little goofy with the cartoon animations, but okay.
In his book Guns, Germs, and Steel, Jared Diamond outlines six reasons why some animals have never successfully been domesticated.
Yeah, so I can kind of go over these real quick. Diet is one. You have to be able to feed the animal something that, you know, it's got to be fairly Catholic in its diet, where it'll eat just about anything, and be pretty easygoing about that. If an animal like a panda requires really, really specific foods, it's going to be extremely expensive to feed, and you're not going to be able to domesticate it. A panda is actually the most expensive animal to feed in a zoo. More expensive than a rhinoceros, more expensive than a polar bear, more expensive than an elephant. Pandas, you've got to give them tons and tons of bamboo, and it has to be a few very particular species of bamboo that they eat, because they won't eat anything else. So diet is something that, you know, makes it really difficult, you know? An animal has to be pretty easygoing about what it eats in order for it to be domesticable. Growth rate is another thing. They have to be able to grow pretty quickly. If it's an animal that takes 40 years to mature, well, shoot, that's a lot of time that you have to keep that animal, and it's not necessarily going to be a good candidate for being domesticated. Problems of captive breeding. A lot of animals won't breed in captivity. They will not reproduce except in the wild. So obviously, you can't domesticate them then. Nasty disposition, yeah, if they bite you and latch on like a zebra, that's one of those things, it's just not going to work. Tendency to panic, you know, an animal's got to be pretty even-tempered, it's got to be comfortable around people. That's actually one of the things that pigeons do really well. Pigeons are very comfortable around people. Pigeons love to be around human beings. It's one of the reasons they do so well in cities, they're just comfortable around human beings. And then social structure, if they've got some sort of like a social hierarchy, like horses do, but zebras don't, apparently, then that makes it easier for them to, like, accept a human overlord, I guess. You know? If they already kind of have that hardwired into them, that, like, they have a hierarchical social structure, then it makes it easier for them to put up with domestication. So, yeah. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah.
Before we look at these, it's important to understand what we mean by domesticated.
Yep.
We can define it as a species bred in captivity.
This is it.
And thereby modified.
This is the horizon which marks the extinction of the dinosaurs.
We might skip the rest of this video.
Level, and out in here, there are dinosaur fossils.
Andrew Holding.
Above this level, in these rocks, there are no dinosaur fossils. So I'm actually standing on the level that marks the extinction of the dinosaurs.
Thank you, Andrew Holding.
Holding and their eight raiders have stumbled below that level. Let's talk dinosaurs.
Welcome back to Paleontologizing, Andrew Holding, and how did your stream go? I hope it was really good. Sorry, as I look at the wrong camera. I'm still readjusting to this because I just got back from the field a few days ago. Welcome back to Paleontologizing. I'm glad you could be here. Tell me how your stream went. I want to hear about it. But yeah. Yeah. The Raven says, I like how they say nasty disposition when really the zebra has the right to bite their captor. Yeah. Solidarity, Raven. Agreed. And Hanger says, if a dinosaur bone was discovered on the moon, would you volunteer for an expedition to dig? No. There's so many more dinosaurs here on Earth. Why would I go to the moon? For one measly dinosaur bone? I have left more dinosaur bones behind in the field than most people will ever see in their whole lives, you know? Yeah. That reminds me, there's a thing that... And I think I know what you're talking about here.
Hello, I'm Sam Neill from Jurassic Park. Let's protect our fossils, because if they're removed, America loses them forever.
Stephanie, it's true. Thank you for following. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. And oh boy. This is one of those reasons that I don't... FL science. We are pleased to inform you that there are probably dinosaur remains on the moon. This is completely false. Completely wrong. Not a chance. And I very much doubt that they consulted any scientists, or at least any paleontologists on this. Thanks to a glorious piece of science writing that has been shared online over the last few days. Oh boy. What is this? People are now learning what astrophysicists and possibly astronauts have known for a long time. There are most likely tiny chunks of dinosaurs sitting up there on the moon. Not a chance. Not a chance. When was this written? 2021? I should have known better by now. 65 million years ago. It's 66. Now we know it was 66 million years ago. Before humankind took one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. Dinosaurs made it to our satellite, blah, blah, blah. No. So, this bugs me so much when non-paleontologists feel the need to comment on fossil science. It's so annoying. Anyway. Yeah. As Peter Brennan explains in his book The Ends of the World, the meteor hit Earth. It wasn't a meteor, it was an asteroid. It was traveling at such tremendous speed that as the asteroid collided with the Earth, in the sky above it, where there should have been air, the rock had punched a hole in outer space, blah, blah, blah. With the Earth and rock went dinosaur bones. I mean... I suppose in, like, a... If there are little bits of Earth ejecta on the moon, then I guess there is a tiny chance that some of them may have formerly been... molecules that existed in the body of a dinosaur? But to say that there are dinosaurs on the moon is completely wrong. It just... Yeah. Anyway, pretty frustrating. Pretty frustrating. But yeah. Yeah. Oh, and Sir Ronlin says, pedantically, most meteors are asteroids. They become meteors when they hit the atmosphere and meteorites when they hit the surface. Are you sure about that, Sir Ronlin? You would know better than I would, I'm sure, on this particular topic, but I've asked like numerous astronomers and stargazers and even an astrophysicist once, what's the difference between an asteroid, a meteor, and a meteorite? And like, I get different answers about what constitutes a meteor and what constitutes a meteorite. I've heard some people say that it's the meteor only describes the light phenomenon that you see with your eyes and not the actual object itself, which is called a meteoroid. But then when it impacts the surface, it becomes a meteorite. I've had some people tell me that the object itself is called a meteoroid or a meteorite, and it doesn't actually matter when it hits the surface. And I've had other people tell me that, like, they're all interchangeable and it's all just semantics. Like, it doesn't actually matter. And so I'm really confused about this. Yeah. The difference is the spelling. There you go, Charlie's Dragon. A pragmatic response there. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. Anyway. And very funny hangers. He was 47 when he was on the moon. He must be the oldest astronaut to have walked on the moon then, right? Yeah. Anyway. Yeah, that is old for astronauting. I think I agree, Claire Burr. Yeah. Anyway. It's like magma versus lava. Yeah, so that's the thing with magma and lava. That's easy for me to understand. Because it's lava when it's above the Earth's surface, and it's magma when it's subterranean. So once it emerges, it becomes lava. Like, that is easier enough for me to understand, I think. But yeah, meteor versus meteoroid versus meteorite. And then there was a third one, or a fourth one, too. There was another meteo-something term, and I don't remember what it was. But I don't know. Yeah. Yeah, space travel will get you nowhere fast. Andy, I dig the pun. It got me. It's not micrometeoroid, it was something else. Because those are just... That's pretty self-explanatory, City Wanderer, but thank you for bringing it up. Yeah. And Ryu Spitfire, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome. Sorry, I missed your question. How are you? And regarding asteroids, meteors, and meteorites, it's hard that it's to do with composition. Could be very wrong, so I'm interested to know, too. I don't even know. And, like, I've looked up a bunch of articles about this, and they all contradict each other, so I don't know. And Alex Vixen says, asteroids are smaller than a planet, but are larger than the pebble-sized objects we call meteoroids. See, I thought meteoroid was more of a catch-all term, because it means meteor form. Like, when we say tyrannosauroid, that is tyrannosaurids, part of Tyrannosauridae, the specific tyrannosaurid family, plus their allies and, you know, close relatives would be tyrannosauroids. So oid, to me, kind of connotes a larger group. But I could very well be wrong about that in this particular context. Maybe it's different in astronomy. Yeah, a meteor is what happens when a meteoroid, a small piece of asteroid or comet, burns up upon entering the Earth's atmosphere, creating a streak of light in the sky. Meteorites are the ones that hit the ground, so technically an asteroid which hits the surface should be called an asterite. Oh boy. See, that, again, confusing. It's all confusing. Gah. Yeah. Stinkfruit, thank you for potentially clarifying this. They say when it is moving through outer space, it is called a meteoroid. When it enters Earth's atmosphere, it becomes a meteor. When it falls to the Earth's surface, it is a meteorite. So you're saying it's the same object. Meteoroid, outside of Earth's atmosphere. Meteor, when it's going through Earth's atmosphere, however brief that may be. Meteorite, when it contacts the surface? Ken says, a non-asteroid meteor form. There you go. Like our non-hadrosaurid hadrosauroid that we'll be exploring later when we talk about these new dinosaurs described this summer. Yeah. Well, sounds meteor wrong to you, Biosalad Girk? Fair enough. Yeah. Gimp, like, that's interesting. Yeah. Oh, and the Speedo? No, that's a different one. Actually, two other ones, Brannington. We'll talk about those too. But, anyway, we've got things to do here, everybody. Shoot, I've got to look at my to-do list here. We're falling behind. We're an hour and a half into the stream, and we've not yet assembled our Allosaur pieces, nor have we done our dinosaur deep dives. Before we get into our new dinosaurs. So let's do those real quick, shall we? For those of you who are not familiar, I'm currently printing a life-size Allosaurus skull. Allosaurus, one of everybody's favorite North American Morrison theropods. There we go. This is it right here. It's gonna be... Well, it already is. 83 centimeters long, the lower jaw right here. And, yeah, we're printing the entire skull. We're printing, I'm not sure which piece this is right here, but we had several pieces that finished printing after yesterday's stream. And we are going to assemble those pieces live on here. So let's go ahead and do that. Yeah. So let's do it. This is, by the way, well, can anybody guess which part this is? Hang on a minute. Sorry, I'm a little rusty with this. Where did my sound effects go? Let's see. That's not it. Shoot. Did that button disappear? What happened to this? Marbles. 3D printer. I'm not sure where those went. Strange. Okay, anyway, I was gonna play the Jeopardy music while I asked you which part of the skull this is. Can anybody take a guess? Yeah, not an ear bone, Andy. But, something. There it is. Yeah, which part of the skull might this be? Oh. And Ken, if you're watching, it's gonna be really obvious to you. Yeah. And we're seeing some correct answers here. Yes, indeed. Yeah, nice. If you answered anything like the snout or the snoot or maxilla premaxilla or upper jaw or anything like that, then you got that correct. This is the front of the skull of our Allosaurus fragilis here, and I just downloaded this monograph by former state paleontologist of Utah, Jim Madsen. He did a really cool monograph on this. Thank you for the follow there, Silent Kevin. I appreciate it. I think it was in... There we go. There's our skull there. So this is the front of the skull, the premaxilla and the maxilla. And then we're going to get up into the nasals too pretty soon here. But that is the front of the skull. This bone right here, this tooth-bearing bone, that's the same bone you have right there, and your snoot, right here. And then the maxilla, which is that bone there. Actually, with humans, I think it's just a maxilla, huh? Our premaxilla got, like, shunted up. We have such weird skulls as human beings. We're such, such weird critters. But yeah. PhD in Assyriology. That's very cool, Silent Kevin. Well, welcome, welcome. Thank you for the follow, and welcome to Paleontologizing. I hope you stick around. I'm sure we've got some similarities here, and hopefully I can hold your attention. Let's go ahead and start assembling this.
Dinosaurs were the sort of creatures you might think of as inhabiting another planet.
Sure.
Or the kind you dream of in a bad nightmare.
Diagonal, thank you for the 30 months. I appreciate that very much. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. But yeah. The parts that I have printed right now are as follows. This one. And this one. And that one. Let's get them put on there. I'm excited about this, because this project is going to take a few months, but I'm going to be assembling it piece by piece every day on stream, along with 3D printing more live. So this one should be done shortly after the end of today's stream, and we can put this piece on tomorrow. But let's get some glue. Let's start putting this together. Bruce Lee says, love your streams. I love your chats, Bruce Lee. Thank you for the kind words. Welcome to Paleontology.
Let's protect our fossils, because if they're removed, America loses them forever.
And thank you, Stephanie 5001, for that tier one sub. I appreciate that very, very much. Thank you, thank you. Welcome to the community. Enjoy those emotes. Emotes like these and these and these and these and these. And these. And, oh, those are for tier three. But, all of them except for the last ones. Yeah. Anyway, good stuff. Appreciate you, Stephanie. I'm going to put this down on my desk so as not to get this noxious glue on my leather desk pad. And, good, our overhead camera is working. Let's go ahead and assemble this bad boy. Some wonderful 3D gloop here, which is the best adhesive I know of.
If you're feeling a bit cheated, try blaming the dinosaurs.
Thank you, Purple Lurple, for those 100 bits. That is lovely. It really is. Yeah. 3D gloop. This stuff is fantastic for assembling 3D prints like this, and I got this as a gift from Patrick Pirate and Blue Front. So we'll be using this to assemble these parts of the upper maxilla here. And I have, I think, one of those right here. There we go. Yeah, putting this part on right here. Is that right? There we go, yeah. Nice, it fits in nice and snug. Almost, it snaps into place, but we're still gonna put some adhesive on it. Just for good measure. So let's do that. Yeah. And so this is really, really nice stuff because it actually like physically melts the plastic in order to make an extra strong bond here. This is excellent stuff, and I like it a lot. And I need to get some more of it. I should really put some more of this on the Amazon wish list, because for too long I'm probably going to run out. And it is good stuff. There we go. Snap this into place like that. Beautiful. Very nice. And I don't even have to hold that there. It just snaps right in. That's fantastic. Next, this piece is gonna go right here like that. And I will have to hold that in place. But that's fine. Yeah. I would probably be a lot more careful with this if I were not streaming right now, trying to do 10 things at once. But, yeah. Hold that in place there. Very nice. All right. And oh, and Ken, thank you for redeeming the hydrate. Let me do that in a minute.
Prehistoric horrors. What's all this
archaic
anatomy in a
Maja79 girl, thank you for the follow and welcome to Paleontologizing. And thank you, Afay Lilis. Sorry I missed your follow 2 minutes ago. But it's great to have you here. Welcome, both of you. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. Oh, and sorry, I missed that from Silent Kevin, too. Yeah. Ken, thank you for bringing that to my attention with that response. Yeah, there has been some really cool work being done on the Isle of Skye in Scotland, I believe. There's a brand new big old pterosaur from the Jurassic called Djark. Djark, I think. Let me see if I can pull up a video. There we go.
A dinosaur?
What?
Thank you, 5-inch floppy, for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. I only used to use, what was it? Was it the 5-inch floppies or the 3.5? The ones that aren't as floppy as the old ones. But you're talking about floppy disks. Yeah. I used to use those back when I was in school, believe it or not. Despite, of course, being very young, as all Twitch streamers are. You know, I am, of course, 21 and single. But, I don't know, so maybe take it as a sign of poverty or something that I used to use floppy disks. Interpret that however you like. But I used floppy disks back in school, too, and I appreciate your follow, Floppy. And Nate Boy, thank you for the follow, too. Welcome to the channel. It's good to have you here. Let's take a look at this about fossils from the Isle of Skye. There we go.
The sky is the largest pterosaur ever discovered from the Jurassic period. The ancient flying reptile had a wingspan of 2.5 meters or 8 feet and would have flown over the heads of dinosaurs 170 million years ago. Here's our science correspondent, Victoria Gill.
Ooh, not bad.
And it's pretty symmetrical.
Hidden in the rock for 170 million years, the teeth and bones of a Jurassic reptile. After racing the tide to cut out the limestone that entombed their discovery, the team had a rocky journey to bring it back to their lab.
Thank you, Neverwinter. That makes
but
sense. 3.5s of the hard floppies.
This okay. Isle of Skye pterosaur that they've named Djark Skianark, Gaelic for winged reptile.
I think it's a lot clearer if we put the head back.
There's Steve Broussardi right there, just like Ken was talking about. There's paleontologist at the University of Edinburgh, Steve Broussardi. And there's Natalia Jugliesca right there. I think she might be lead author on this study. Yeah.
Can't scan it.
Then we got zip drives. What's a zip drive, 5-inch floppy? Is that another name for like a flash drive or a USB storage drive? Yeah. Huh. Your mom used to bring home punch cards in the 70s. Very cool, purple. I used a dot matrix printer back when I used to work at an auto parts store. That was fun with the, like, all those holes in the sides, the perforations. Yeah. Some businesses still use dot matrix printers. It's wild. But yeah. Yeah.
But we can put it right back there, join it up with the neck, and you can see the neck.
Nice.
And it leads to a body. You have a wing on each side. Over here, you have the hand with these feisty, sharp little claws, and then you have
beautiful preservation there. Here, I'm going to be right back. Hang on a minute.
So how significant is this one?
Oh, this is far and away the best thing we've ever found on Sky. To get something like this preserved in 3D is just a one in a billion thing.
The hollow bones of this flying reptile are very fragile, but X-ray scans of the skull have revealed even more detail.
Talk me through what you have in your hands.
I'm holding a model of Djark Skianark. It was commissioned by a local artist, and it's more or less how the creature might have looked like in real life. Can see how well adapted to flight it was. It had this elongate wing finger, which anchored entire membrane. It was also very streamlined. You can see how the jaw was related to flying and catching fishes filled with those very sharp teeth. It has a very long tail, which was used as a rudder when in flight. And yeah, it's absolutely charismatic. I love him. He's so goofy.
We walked in Jurassic footprints when we visited the sky with this same research team back in 2015.
And you can see the toes.
Fossilized depressions left by giant sauropods, the biggest animals ever to have walked the Earth.
And this pretty cool.
Fossil, the researchers say, is the largest pterosaur from that same period.
Yeah.
You can see with this model, this is the
Ramphorhynchus
of a Jurassic pterosaur skull, and this
holy
is
cow,
the newly discovered fossil from the Isle of Skye. So this was a big flying reptile.
Pretty incredible. Yeah.
The team's now sending it on another journey, this time just down the road to the National Museum of Scotland, where it will eventually be put on display. But the Jurassic,
I bet you it's on display already.
Slab weighs almost 200 kilos. It's a humble last trip on a pallet for a creature that's been buried since the age of the dinosaurs.
Pretty awesome.
BBC News in Edinburgh.
And we caught a glimpse of him in Victoria's report. Let's talk now to paleontologist Professor Steve Brusati from the University of Edinburgh. Great to have you with us today. And I know that.
So Steve Brusati was actually the consultant on the Jurassic World movies, at least the second and third one. So I don't know if that's an honor or a horror, but anyway, yeah.
That you have officially unveiled the pterosaur at the National Museums of Scotland, where it will be in the permanent collection. What an exciting moment for you.
Thank you. And you saw in Vic's piece there, this is a big animal. We were struggling with that slab. And that's the real significance. We have a Jurassic-aged pterosaur or a pterodactyl.
Pretty cool.
And this thing was as big as the biggest flying birds today. Its wingspan would have been over 8 feet wide. It would have been wider than a king-size bed. And nobody had ever found anything like this in Scotland before, or really from anywhere else in the world. So we're very, very excited. And we're very happy to be unveiling it today at the National Museum of Scotland.
Very cool stuff. Yeah. Anyway, I'll give you the link if you want to watch the rest of that video. There it is. But we got to continue assembling this so I can get on with other stuff that's planned for today. I think we've got some dinosaur deep dives to do left over from yesterday. And yeah, this is going to go right on there. See how the addition of this just makes the snout really pop. That is really nice. So let's get this put on there. And again, for anybody who's just tuning in, we are 3D printing right there and assembling pieces of our life-size Allosaurus fragilis skull. This sucker's gonna be almost a meter long. And yeah, so let's put this other piece on real quick, and then we'll continue with what we're doing for today. Yeah. So, I'm gonna put a little bit of adhesive on here, on this surface. Bunch. We'll drip it right onto there. Thank you for the follow there. I work at McDonald's. Hope they're paying you well. You guys need a union. But welcome, welcome. Thanks for following. Some more on there, kind of gloop it on. And here we go. Beautiful. Very nice. Hopefully that'll do it. I'm gonna... Paul Atreides, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. Silent Kevin says, I've got one question. What would you say is the goofiest looking dinosaur? Ooh, give me a minute here. And I'll show you some contenders. Dinosaurs are a very diverse group, and there are a lot of potential goofiest dinosaurs, so I'll let you decide. All right, we'll let that sit and dry cure for a while. There, keep an eye on the 3D printer while I'm putting it back. Oh. Nice. All right, goofiest dinosaurs. Immediately, what jumps to mind are therizinosaurs. Let's see. I'm trying to find one particular scene here. There we go. Let's hope this works. There we go. Sorry, the subtitle. I have to reverse this, so the subtitles aren't going to work, unfortunately. But here's one contender for one of the goofiest looking dinosaurs. We call a therizinosaur. Take a look. Look at what it encounters here. Yeah. Yeah. I love this line. That is John Goodman, Ridley, yeah. Narrating, not the dinosaur. Ooh! Yeah. So yeah, therizinosaurs are incredibly weird dinosaurs. Just really, really bizarre. And they're a good contender for some of the weirdest looking dinosaurs, I would say. There's Erlikosaurus right there, which is a member of this family. They're fairly close to the ancestry of birds, but these are, they're a group of theropods, two-legged meat-eating dinosaurs, but these guys actually evolved to eat plants. So rather than your typical, like, horizontal backboned, sleek, fast-running predator, these guys evolved to kind of, like, rock back on their hind legs in almost like a Godzilla-type posture, and they developed these huge pot bellies for digesting plants, and they've got these long arms tipped with these ridiculous claws that they use probably for pulling down branches to eat leaves. Just incredibly weird animals. Therizinosaurs, they are strange. They're a good contender for the weirdest dinosaurs. But a lot of other theropods are right there too. You've got like Scansoriopteryx. Really weird creature. This is probably a juvenile, but they've got super weird skeletons where, like, their middle finger is, like, longer than their thigh bone. Longer than their femur. That's almost certainly a hatchling. There's one reconstruction of it, but these animals almost certainly had feathers coming off of those hands. They would have had wings, basically. So this kind of, like, crazy long finger thing, it wouldn't have been like that. They would have been much more like this. Either they had a skin membrane, or they had feathers to make little wings, basically. Yeah. But they're super strange, too. And then... yeah. Here's another really weird dinosaur here. Take a look. Oh, there's a weird dinosaur too. Steven Ernest, thank you for the follow. And Ermi 001, thank you for the follow too. Appreciate that. It's good to have you here. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Would you like to see another really weird looking dinosaur? This might be the weirdest looking dinosaur. You ready? This is called a silky chicken. Ask any paleontologist, ask any evolutionary biologist, ask any ornithologist, bird scientist. They'll tell you birds are living dinosaurs. What a weird looking dinosaur, right? Incredibly strange. Yeah. Is that a tribble? Says Ken. They probably don't reproduce as fast. But look at that face. Wow. Yeah. Let's see if I can find video of maybe like bizarre chicken breeds. Or bizarre birds. Or silky chicken. There we go. Can I find a short video on these guys? Let's see. Let's try that. Those are cows. Those are pigs. Show us the dinosaurs. There we go.
The silky is a breed of chicken named for its fluffy plumage, which is said to feel like silk or satin. Silkies are well known for their calm, friendly temperament and are among the most docile of poultry.
Nice.
Silkies most likely made their way from China to the West via the Silk Route and maritime trade.
That's where they get their name, I assume.
It was recognized officially in North America with acceptance into the Standard of Perfection in 1874.
Tomjin says, even pigeons? Yes, pigeons are dinosaurs. All birds are dinosaurs. Absolutely, yeah. And stop eating my sesame cakes says, I happen to be an expert in bird law, and he's 100% correct. Thank you, sesame cakes. I appreciate that. Thanks for sharing your expertise.
Once silkies became more common in the West, many myths were perpetuated.
Penguins are dinosaurs too. Absolutely, Mr. Broccoli.
Early Dutch breeders told buyers they were a cross between chickens and rabbits, while sideshows promoted them as having actual fur.
That's funny.
Besides their fluffy plumage, silkies have several other unusual qualities, such as black skin and bones, grayish black.
Wait, they have black bones? Slow down a second. Is that right? That's nuts.
Blue earlobes and five toes on each foot.
Wait, what? Do they have polydactyly too? I'm sorry. We gotta look this up. Here. Silky, Chinese chicken breed. Polydactyly, white fur. Melanism extends beyond the skin to the animal's connective tissue as a rare trait, and in chickens it is caused by fibromelanosis, which is a rare mutation believed to have begun in Asia. The silky and several other breeds descended from Asian stock possess the mutation. Interesting. The breed has several other unusual qualities such as black skin and bones, blue earlobes, and five toes on each foot, whereas most chickens only have four. That's crazy. Holy moly, look at that. One, two, three, four, five. Hallux, and then digit one, two, three, and then another one? That's crazy. I did not know that. Wow. That's pretty cool. I wonder what the skeleton looks like in there, how many digits they actually have. Because it almost looks like that's an additional hallux. Like it's the same as their dew claw, which is equivalent to your thumb or your big toe. Where it's typically got, you know, just one bone there, and then the ungual. That's really bizarre. I should look into that. That sounds really interesting. I wonder if, like, developmental biologists have studied this. That's pretty wild. Anyway, that's a weird-looking dinosaur. Yeah. To get back to our Allosaurus here, we have now...
Hey, can I just get a single living dinosaur?
Thank you, Oswill, for the follow. Welcome, welcome. There is the snout of our Allosaurus now completed. Including the first bit of the nasals right there. Excellent. Yeah. So you can see the whole eye socket. We got some filament hanging off of here. Pull that off. Yeah. But yeah. Good stuff. This is what we call the nares, which is where the fleshy nostrils would be in life. Probably closer to, like, here in life, the actual fleshy part of the nostril. But this is the nasal fenestra, or the nares, right there. And then there's the tooth sockets underneath, where all of the teeth go. Like you see there in Jim Madsen's diagram. Excellent. So we are well on our way to getting the full thing printed and assembled. I'm very excited about this. And another big chunk is printing right now. That should be done in about 3 hours, I hope. So we'll put that part on tomorrow. Excellent. Yeah. And Mr. Broccoli says, what came first, the dinosaur or the egg? Critters have been laying eggs for several hundred million years before the first dinosaurs evolved. So eggs definitely came first, Mr. Broccoli. Yeah.
I'm here to applaud the work of vertebrate paleontologists.
Well, thank you, Nothing Bout. It's good to have you here. Thanks for the follow. Welcome, welcome. Yeah. And recreational cephalopod. How many of those traits are a result of inbreeding mutation? That's almost all of those for the silky chicken. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Yeah. Most breeders inbreed, he doesn't. That's cool, Araya. I mean, that'll breed healthier animals, most likely. Yeah. And hey, Alex Fixin, the egg invented the dinosaurs, which invented the chicken. I suppose you could say that. Yeah. Anyway. Here. Gonna ask you a question here, chat. Do we have either Musaica or Smorphosaurus in the chat right now? Because they have each redeemed dinosaur deep dives yesterday, and I've not gotten around to those yet. So, Musaica or Smorphosaurus, are you here right now? If you are, I'll do each of your dinosaur deep dives. Whoever's here. And if not, then we'll just jump into our new dinosaurs.
Tradoon!
From summer 2023. Babushkaudio, thank you. Babushka Audio. What a great name. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Cheers, thanks for the follow. Yeah. So yeah. You got it right? Great username. Welcome. It's good to have you here. I hope you stick around. Let me know if you've got any questions about dinosaurs, about fossils in general, about the history of life on Earth, all that good stuff. And I'm just doing new dinosaurs today, Gimpleg. Just newly described dinosaurs. If I did a bunch of papers on different vertebrate animals, or even just new taxa of vertebrate animals described over the summer, we'd have too many. So we're just doing dinosaurs. And mosasaurs are not dinosaurs. They're actually a kind of lizard displacer. Good question. Yeah. What's my favorite dinosaur? I've got a bunch, Bruce Lee. But let me briefly show you one of my favorites. It's not in that command there. This right here is one of my very favorite dinosaurs. This is Trirarchuncus prairiensis. I sculpted this and then 3D printed it. We did this live on air, actually. That was a ton of fun. If you go to the YouTube page, you could probably see the VODs for this. But this is the very first dinosaur to actually bear my name in the, well, at least in the sense that I'm an author on the paper. I'm one of the authors on this publication in the Journal of Cretaceous Research. Trirarchuncus prairiensis. This is what we call an alvarosaur, or a mononychine alvarosaur. Would have looked something like this in life. A little two-legged dinosaur, covered with feathers, ridiculously long legs, ridiculously short arms, with ridiculously big thumb claws. It has basically one finger on each hand. It may have had two vestigial fingers behind it, but it's mostly got that huge thumb claw that it probably used for, well, let me show you. And don't have nightmares there now, whoa. Don't have nightmares at all. Let me show you what this critter might be like in life.
Dinosaurs creatures you might think of as inhabiting another planet. Or the kind you dream of in a bad nightmare.
Yeah, not a nightmare.
Opening cans of soup.
But thank you, Spartan. Did it use those for opening cans of soup? Well, here's a neat little video from Prehistoric Planet about one of its very close relatives. This dinosaur that you're about to see might actually be the ancestor of this one. Because this one's from the very, very end of the Age of Dinosaurs. The Upper Hell Creek Formation. In the Maastrichtian stage, 66 million years ago, just before the dinosaurs, except for birds, go extinct. But this one here in the video might be the ancestor of Trirarchuncus. Oh, hang on.
Mononychus is a desert specialist.
Mononychus meaning one claw.
Such hypersensitive directional hearing gives her a mental map of this hollow log. What lies within?
So what's it trying to get inside the log?
She now uses...
What do you think? What's she listening for in there? Maybe gift subs? Bits, perhaps? What do you think, chat?
She now uses the weapon that gives this hunter its name.
The phone? Hello, there you go, Claire.
Single giant claw. Just what she needs to open a termite's nest.
Tasty. Yeah.
And she has another special piece of equipment. A flexible tongue.
Yeah.
Twice the length of her head.
So, we don't know about that. Those don't fossilize, but... it would make sense. These animals probably did have an elongate tongue. Meal.
If only termites weren't quite so irritating.
That's from Prehistoric Planet. So anyway, yeah, our animal, Trirarchuncus, would have looked a lot like this. But this is a dinosaur that's very near and dear to my heart.
If they're removed, America loses them forever.
A Sanguiner, thank you for the Prime sub. I appreciate that very much. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. Yeah. Trirarchuncus. Here's our dinosaur. There it is on Wikipedia. And then... There we go. Oh, who's this dingus right here? Yeah, that's me on the author list. And there it is in the Journal of Cretaceous Research. Yeah, the last Alvarezsaurid. So ours is a lot like Mononychus, but later in time. And it's got a very special place in my heart. What a cool critter. Yeah. Anyway, and Nuau, I'll see you later. You sleep well. Yeah. Anyway.
And if dinosaurs had not died, I imagine that mammals would still be small creatures like this living in the nooks and crannies of their world.
Yep.
We wouldn't be here.
Agreed, PK Bree. Thank you for being here, though, and thank you for following. It's good to have you here. Now, without further ado, we've taken care of all the business for today, and we're only 2 hours and 16 minutes into the stream. Why don't we finally get into the new dinosaurs that have been published while I was away in the field? While I was away from the office digging up dinosaurs in Wyoming and Utah, there were nine, count them, nine new dinosaurs published. And, here we go. I even tweeted about this earlier. There we go. Or X'd about it, or whatever you're supposed to say now. Wow, what a stupid website. No less than nine new dinosaur genera were published while I was out in the field this summer, and I'm exploring each of them on today's Twitch stream. So there's some of them right there. Let's get into this, shall we? Excuse me. Oh, shoot, and I totally forgot to do a... Oh, boy, hang on a minute. Yeah. Let's put that right there. I had so many issues with my cameras and everything before this that I completely forgot to make a new button on the stream deck. So let me just do that real quick. Scene, there we go. And there we go. That should do it. Yeah. Excellent. Here we go. Beautiful. So, on average, a new dinosaur species or genus is described about... And when I say described, I mean published on in the scientific literature. It's about once every 2 weeks nowadays. In the year 2020, for instance, there were 48 new species of dinosaur published, which is almost one per week. And then it's been going down a little bit since then, largely due to COVID, I think. This year we have something like 20 new species of dinosaur that have been described in the year 2023. So we're actually going up a little bit if this trend continues. We'll see. But, there we go. Here's a little presentation that I've put together, especially for today's broadcast, about the nine new dinosaurs that were published on while I was away in the field. These are, I wasn't able to talk about these because I wasn't paying very close attention to the news or the literature because I was out there digging dinosaurs out in the deserts of Wyoming and Utah. But now we're going to go over them live. I'm glad you're here for this. Exciting stuff. So, there we go. Nine new dinosaurs here. You ready for this? Been learning this new presentation software, so hopefully you like this. We'll see. It adds a little bit of pizzazz, but we'll see if it's worth it. So, I left for the field, or I left my office at least, on June 1st of this year. And I got back on August 11th, I think. It's been a good while, and there's a lot of dinosaurs that we missed. Let's jump in to the month of June here and see what we have got. Here we go. For the month of June, we've got four new dinosaurs. Two of which were published, I think, while I was at a paleontological conference in Utah. Would you like to see our new one? Or our first one? I'm not 100% sure how to pronounce this one because I haven't actually heard it spoken yet. But I'm going to say Migmenichion for this one. This is a beautiful little theropod dinosaur from Asia. Migmenichion Liang, which is published on June 5th of this year. From the early Cretaceous of Inner Mongolia, China, about Aptian in age. So it's either Middle Cretaceous or Upper Cretaceous, depending on your taste, I suppose. But it's from the, just above halfway through the Cretaceous period. Or no, hang on, no, that's the Lower Cretaceous. What am I saying? Aptian is... Yeah. Bimedi, thank you for the follow, Bimedi. Welcome, welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. And so if any of you remember our dinosaur Dourlong that we talked about, newly described last year in 2022, this dinosaur is coeval with that one. And when I say coeval, I mean that it's from the same time and the same place. They would have coexisted. And Dinosaur Wings, thank you for the follow. Holy cow, welcome to Paleontologizing. Holy moly. Thanks for following. It sounds like you're in the right place. Thanks for joining us. Yeah. Yeah. Does anybody have an idea what this dinosaur looks like? What does it look similar to? Anybody have any ideas about this? What kind of dinosaur does that look like? Yeah. They're both really evil together. Wait, why, Ken? and no toe claw. Yeah, 6 foot turkey. It's kind of bizarre. This one is known from fairly scanty material, and we'll talk about that. I think I might even have the paper for this guy. We're going to look at the original literature as much as we can. But looks like Tradoon, kind of Triceratops, yeah. Yeah. So it's known from an incomplete forelimb, and that's, I think, all we have from this animal. Is an arm that's not complete. But based on that one arm, we can tell that it is a Maniraptoran dinosaur. So it's a member of the two-legged meat-eating dinosaur group that includes birds. We call Maniraptorans. But it comes out pretty basal on the tree, so it's got primitive characteristics. Although, my first thought in a situation like this is it actually primitive, or is it just an immature individual? Because if you're not full-grown, chances are you're going to have primitive characteristics on a phylogeny. So we'll see. But according to the paper, they've got affinities with Oviraptorosaurs and Therizinosaurs. Let's go ahead and look at the paper for this critter. Here on Paleontologizing, I try and show you the original literature as often as is possible. I think it's really important for people to actually see scientific papers, because most people just aren't exposed to that, you know? How many people are reading a scientific paper in their daily lives? How many people in the general public ever actually see a scientific paper during their whole life? Honestly, probably not that many. It's important to look at this kind of thing, to, you know, get the science straight from the science horse's mouth as often as is possible. So here we have in the Journal of Cretaceous Research, this is the same journal that Triarchuncus was published in, A new theropod dinosaur from the Lower Cretaceous Longjiang Formation of Inner Mongolia, China. And yep, there we go. Available online 5th of June, 2023. So it's erected based on appendicular skeleton material from the Lower Cretaceous Pigeon Hill locality, Inner Mongolia, China. The theropod shows a peculiar combination of features in the hand, in part shared with therizinosaurs or veraptorosaurs and the enigmatic Fukui Venator from Japan. I think if we were to find more of this animal, it would probably come out elsewhere in a phylogenetic tree, I would guess. It's probably a result of it being immature and incomplete, but that's my guess. I don't know. I didn't publish on this thing or dig it up. Yeah, and there's the locality there in China, near Moki, apparently, in Inner Mongolia. Inner Mongolia is not actually within the country of Mongolia. It's in China, if anybody is confused about that. There we go. So, Mongolia is up here. Its own landlocked country. And then here's China. Inner Mongolia is an autonomous region in the People's Republic of China.
The history of life is very quirky for
Chile. Blue Laser, thank you for the 7 months. Huzzah, indeed.
Literally here, yeah. Only because of the good fortune of dinosaur extinction.
Huzzah.
It's true, Blue Laser. Thank you for your ongoing support. I really appreciate it. So yeah, so that's where in the world this dinosaur is from, right about in there. Yeah. Continuing on through the paper. Is this actually the locality there? That's really wild. Is it from like slate or something? Well, this is a stratigraphic diagram showing where it's from. And there is the fossil. This is a forelimb of the animal. You can see that beautiful claw right there. Yeah, we don't have a whole lot from this critter. But look at that gorgeous claw. Holy cow. Finger bone. More finger bones. And then the arm goes up that way. Lovely. So pretty scanty material. It'll be interesting to find out if this critter is... you know, what's really going on with it. But... this is what we got so far, and we think it might look kind of roughly like this. This is like a generic Maniraptoran dinosaur. Not quite a Dromaeosaur, not a Troodontid, not a Therizinosaur, not an Oviraptorosaur. We don't really know what it looked like, except it had the kinds of hands associated with a Maniraptoran dinosaur. So yeah. It'll be interesting if this turns out to be valid, you know, to see what happens with this in the long term. Yeah. So yeah, let me catch up to chat here. An Elsevier publication that's easy to access? Impressive, says Caravan. This one was open access. Yeah. I think maybe the authors had some money to... they could pay some extra money in order to make it free to the public. Which is nice. I appreciate that. But yeah. Yeah. Does this count as new taxon named from a single element? There's multiple bones here, Lenina. So I don't know if it could cross off that box on your bingo card. Sorry. But there will be some of those, I'm sure, by the end of the year, so stay tuned. Yeah. But yeah. And where can we access free papers, says Araya Thalia? Well, shoot. Here. Here. Come here. Come. Here. A little bit closer. Okay. You didn't hear it from me, but, there's a resource that you can access online, and it's called, well, don't go spreading this around, but it's called SciHub, S-C-I-H-U-B. and they provide free access to different scientific papers. Stuff that might be paywalled otherwise. It's pretty crummy that a lot of this stuff is paywalled because much of this research is taxpayer funded in the first place. And so you're already paying for that with your tax dollars. And yet these journals get to come in and receive this work for free from scientists. Like, they get all this work for free, and then they're able to charge scientists and the public in order to be able to read it. And anyway, so again, you didn't hear this from me. And keep that under your hat, because, you know, shoot, my whole purpose here is science outreach. And I really don't want to be shut down for this kind of thing. Because you never know who might be watching. These people have got deep pockets, and they're very litigious. And it might be kind of dangerous to share, you know, I'm kidding. But yeah, anyway, you didn't hear that from me. This one is open access though, and so I can probably even give you a link to this paper. There we go. Here is a press release on this critter. This is Fuqui Venator, actually, and not, project all. How do we do? Okay. Anyway. Yep. Here is a link right there to this press release from Cosmo. Wow. Cosmopolitan magazine. Really cool they're actually reporting on science, you know? It's not just, you know, 15 hot tips to blow your boyfriend's mind or anything. No, there it is. New theropod dinosaur from China had peculiar hands. Unfortunately, they did spell theropod wrong. That should be an O and not an A. Theropod. But whatever. It's Cosmo, you know? What can you expect? So yeah. And then you'll find a link to the paper right there where it says published. You just click that. And then there's the paper, and it's actually open access. View PDF. Good stuff. Here's a link to that too. Anyway. Excellent. So welcome to the world, Migmanikaion, Lai Yang. New Maniraptoran dinosaur. We'll see if, shoot, that's the thing. That's the danger of publishing on something where you only have a forelimb. Is like, if they find another almost complete skeleton of this animal, and it doesn't have a forelimb, how do you know if it's the same animal or not? You know, you gotta have more overlapping material than that. So we'll see. We'll see. But, anyway. Blue Laser to the Sky says, Cosmo, dinosaur news and ways to keep the marriage spicy. There you go. Why feathers should be part of your autumn look. Thank you, Kennedy. 15 dinosaurs that would fit in a handbag is more Cosmo style. There you go, Alex Vixen. Yeah, yeah. So yeah, yeah. And, Nado XICLL says, what's the rarest thing you guys have ever found in this world? Well, shoot, that's a really difficult question to answer because there would be only one of them. And there's a bunch of different examples of us only finding one thing, you know? So, yeah, I don't know. It's a really tough one to answer. It is pretty rare to find examples of, like, animals that died while fighting or something like that. Yeah. So, one good example might be this. Here's a really cool fossil fish called Xiphactinus. And it has got another fish preserved in its belly. It probably died while eating this other fish. You know, picture this as like a giant tarpon from hell. It's not actually related to modern tarpon, but, you know, whatever. And the other fish is called Gilicus, so... Yeah, so it seems to have actually died while eating this other fish. And probably choked to death on it. A lot like that. Yeah. And then after it died, the fish, like, when everything was decomposing, kind of slipped further into the innards. And that's how you get that right there. So that's pretty rare to find that kind of thing. But yeah. Yeah. Dying to your own food. There you go. Yeah. Yeah. What about pregnant fossils that show their gender? That's another one, Saranlin. Yeah. Yeah. If an animal actually dies while it's gravid or with embryos inside, that's also pretty rare. But the thing is, even really, really rare things like that, they turn out to be not all that rare because Earth history is so long and we have so many fossils. That even extraordinarily rare events end up being preserved in the fossil record just because we have so much record there, you know? It's like the law of large numbers. So, no toxic? Not toxic. You're welcome for sharing. Thanks for the good question. Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah. And fossilization itself is a rare event. This is true, 6 foot turkey. But with enough time, even rare events end up happening a lot. And that's pretty cool. Yeah, what's not been particularly rare is new dinosaurs being published this summer. So let's get into some more of those. We've got 8 more to cover after this guy. Megmanichion. And what is our next one? Let's take a look. Oops. From the month of June here. We've got a dinosaur that was published on while I was at this conference in Utah, which is pretty cool. I was lucky enough to be able to attend and present research at the Mesozoic Terrestrial Ecosystems Conference. Not the mid-Mesozoic meeting, that was in 2014. But, there we go. So, this was held in Utah, in Salt Lake City. And I actually have an abstract in here. But, let's see. Where was that? Are these in alphabetical order, or are they in... Yep, there's me right there. But, oh, there's our Dinosaurs of Utah chart. Very cool. Fatality. And Gita Aloha.
That's almost a year.
24 months. Almost. Thank you, Gita Aloha, for your ongoing support. That means a lot to me. It really does. Yeah. I was in the poster session on the second day, I think.
Simply astonishing. One of the most singular specimens I've encountered in all my distinguished career.
Or was
enough
that?
About my work. What did you want to show me, Lisa?
Theme session. Is that posters or talks? Anyway, my abstract is in here. Oh, there's Don DeBlue right there. Yeah, very nice. Anyway, it doesn't matter. This dinosaur was published on by Lindsay Zano et al. There we go. Beautiful little beaky plant-eating dinosaur. And Lindsay actually mentioned this in her talk during the week. because it made its way into her talk at one point. And she said that they were on the plane, her team was on the plane coming to Utah to present this conference when they saw this hit the news, that the journal had published it while they were on the plane, which was pretty cool. And this dinosaur is called Ioni Smithi. And if that sounds like kind of an unusual name for a dinosaur, it's because it's got a cool story behind it. Yeah. Published on June 7th, 2023. And it is from the Cretaceous period, the Cenomanian age, kind of middle Cretaceous, or beginning of the late Cretaceous. The Cedar Mountain Formation in Utah, USA. It's named John Smith. Sort of, kind of. This is what we call a speedo. This is actually a term that I'd never heard before, but I learned at this conference. I wonder who came up with this in the first place, but this term speedo was one that Lindsay and other members of her team would use during their talks. And it stands for small-bodied early diverging ornithischian. And so these are fairly small dinosaurs. They walk on two legs, they've got beaks, and they diverge pretty early on. This is what we used to call a hypsilophodont. That's kind of the antiquated term for this. I can't say group of dinosaurs because it's not really a group of dinosaurs. I'll show you what I mean. Back in this book, which was written in the earliest 80s or late 1970s even, the Illustrated Encyclopedia of Dinosaurs, there is a chapter on this general variety of dinosaurs. Where are hypsilophodonts? They're earlier in the arthropods. There we go. Hypsilophodontids. This is no longer considered a valid group of dinosaurs. Hypsilophodontids are now considered kind of a grab bag group. It used to include like Tenontosaurus and Dryosaurus right there. And of course, Hypsilophodon. So these guys are generally like small, beaky, plant-eating dinosaurs. They usually run on two legs. There we go. You know, generally like this. And they're often considered like the Mesozoic equivalent of like a gazelle or an impala or some kind of small antelope like that, you know? They're little, they're fast running, that's their primary means of defense, is running fast away from predators. But it turns out these animals aren't actually closely related to each other. This is not a real clade, this is not a real evolutionary group. It turns out that this kind of dinosaur has evolved again and again and again, and we're kind of trying to figure out, you know, like, how these things are related to each other, if at all. And so this new dinosaur right here, Ioni, might help us figure that out a bit, which is pretty exciting. Anyway, so that term speedo, small-bodied early diverging ornithischian, it's just kind of a nickname for this general form of dinosaur. So these guys that probably ran on two legs, they had beaks, they were plant eaters. Yeah, they're probably not all relatives of one another. Let me show you some examples. Hypsilophodonts. There we go. So basically like this. Little two-legged running dinosaurs that ate plants. They had beaks. Hypsilophodonts. That's your general kind of dinosaur right there. There's a newly described one from a couple years ago, I think. They're like the little deer of the dinosaur world, basically. Little guys like this. Yeah, turns out they're much more complicated than anybody imagined. And so our new one here is known from a partial skeleton, including a nearly complete skull, which is very, very exciting. The skull is the most important part, and it can give us a lot of clues as the animal's biology. So, as to the animal's biology. Yeah. Would they have made good pets? Maybe. Reanimated a bit. I mean, a dinosaur like this is not going to eat you. It's going to be relatively easy to feed and pet. They may have had fuzzy feathers on them. We're still trying to figure that part out.
Take the phone to mommy now.
And who's this?
Take the phone to mommy. It's the dinosaur man.
Okay.
Baby Magic, thank you for the 2 months of support.
I haven't been here for a min. Happy to catch you a guy.
It's good to have you here too, Baby Magic. Thank you for your ongoing support. I appreciate that. I really do. Yeah. So yeah. Yeah. You might even be able to give him a little smooch. Here we go. I bet you I can, Araya. Should I try? Mwah. There we go. Here, let me hold him still first. Grab you like that. Mwah. There we go. But these are, you know, fairly cute little dinosaurs, I suppose. You know? Everybody loves the Speedos. Small-bodied, early diverging ornithischians. They're a big mystery, and we need more people working on critters like this to figure out what's going on with them. But man, they're very cool. And this one's got a nearly complete skull, which is super important. And so it could unite Tenontosaurs and Rabidodontian dinosaurs. Which, if you know your ornithopods, then that's pretty exciting. So let's take a look at the original paper here, shall we? And the artist for this illustration is Jorge Gonzalez. Very nice, Valiant Cheese. Cool. It's a great illustration that they've got there. Yeah. And Iani, there we go. Here's our paper. This is open access. Everybody loves open access papers. An early diverging iguanodontian from the late Cretaceous of North America. And there's Lindsay Zanna right there, lead author. Also Bucky Gates, Haviv Avrahami, Ryan Tucker, and Pete McAvicky. Very nice. So let's take a look at their figures here. But this dinosaur is from the same geologic formation that I was digging in for the past month, or 24 days, whatever you want to call it. And the parts highlighted here in green are the parts that we actually have, which is really, really cool. This is the majority of a skeleton. It's missing the end of the tail and the distal part of the hind limbs, but we've got a nearly complete arm right there, nearly complete rib cage, which is impressive. Champion 7B, thank you for that follow. Welcome, welcome. And a nearly complete skull, which... That's super, super exciting right there. Yeah. Good stuff. And there's one of those skull bones. There's the Premax right there. Really, really lovely. And look at that. Most of the skulls represented. And this, I presume, had been disarticulated when found, so it's really awesome that they've got almost all of these bones here. Not almost all. They probably got about 30 to 50% of the skull. Or at least 30 to 50% of one side of the skull. Super, super cool. Yeah. So really awesome. Really, really awesome. And BKJ says, what is the best fossil feature to be able to distinguish between two similar dinosaurs? It depends what kind of dinosaur it is. Different groups of dinosaurs have got different, what we call, diagnostic characters. They've got different features that distinguish them as being different.
If dinosaurs had not died, I imagine that mammals would still be small creatures like this living in the nooks and crannies of their
True.
World, and we wouldn't be here.
I'm glad you're here, though, Blissful Ignora. Thank you for the follow, and welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to
have
you.
I'm here to applaud the work of vertebrate paleontologists.
And I appreciate your applause there, Tangled Raven. Thank you for the follow.
Neill from Jurassic Park.
Hello, Sam Neill.
Let's protect our fossils, because if they're removed, America loses them forever.
True. Cheers, and thank you, Shivanex. Shivanvex. What a cool name. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Good to have you here. Yeah.
Real dinosaur.
And not toxic. Thanks for clicking that follow button too. I appreciate it. Welcome to the channel. Yeah. So for different groups of dinosaur, there's different parts that are going to be really, really important to find and study and describe. But the general thing is, no matter what kind of dinosaur it is, if you can find any particular part, you want to find a skull. You want the noggin, because the skull is the part that has the most information about the animal itself. If you think about it, the skull is the business end of the animal. It includes all of the most of the sensory organs. You've got eyes and nose and mouth and teeth. You've got ears. You've got the brain there in the skull. And so that's generally the part of the dinosaur that evolves the most quickly. That's true for most animals that have skulls. The skull is the most important part. That's the most diagnostic part. For mammals, I suppose you want the teeth, which are part of, they come out of the skull, you know? But dinosaur teeth are not as diagnostic as mammal teeth. If you found a skull with no teeth at all, that would be far superior to finding just teeth. You want the skull for a dinosaur. That's got the most information. It can tell you the most about that animal. You know, how it experienced the world through its senses, what it ate, you know, how its jaws are constructed. You could have a complete skull of a dinosaur and have more information about what that dinosaur was like than if you had the whole rest of the skeleton with no skull. You want the skull. So it's really exciting that they've got a mostly complete skull here. Very, very cool. Yeah. So anyway, I hope that makes sense. And DinoSaurs, thank you for the follow. DinoSaurs, thank you for make follow of my channel. It's good to have you here on Twitch. And Moohoodles, it is super exciting, isn't it? Yeah. And Moohoodles, just like you, this dinosaur is from Utah. Which is super awesome, too. Yeah, from the Cedar Mountain Formation, the same formation I was digging in. Although, it's from much more recent in time. I was digging at the very bottom of the Cedar Mountain. This is from near the top of the Cedar Mountain. The mustn't touch it, remember. So yeah. There's some more of those skull bones illustrated there. More skull bones, more skull bones. Those are honestly the most important bones because they're from the skull, like we were talking about. There's a lower jaw with those teeth. Look at that beautiful dentary there with those lovely plant-eating teeth. Just gorgeous. Yeah. Really lovely. And they even did some histo on this, which is very cool. So they did some histo sectioning of the teeth to try and ascertain how old the animal was when it died. There's some vertebrae, some ribs. There's a scapula right there, shoulder blade. This is a right scapula, it looks like. That looks like a femur to me. Yeah, very nice. And there is a, what we call a phylogeny, an evolutionary family tree. So here's our new dinosaur, Eoni smithii. And that's really interesting. It's coming out between Mudaburrosaurus and Tenontosaurus? What the heck? But in this model, it comes out between Rhabdodon and Tenontosaurus. Very interesting. So this dinosaur could potentially be a kind of missing link between, I kind of hate that term, but you know, it could provide a phylogenetic bridge, I guess, between this dinosaur we saw in this book earlier. Tenontosaurus right here from Montana and Oklahoma. Tenontosaurus. And Rhabdodon, which you might remember from Prehistoric Planets. Here we go. Rhabdodon. Oh, sorry, Zelmoxes is a Rhabdodontian. There we go. Turn up our volume. There we go.
Boys on rafts like these are washed up on the shores of distant islands.
There we go. These little two-legged, beaky, plant-eating dinosaurs.
If they're very lucky, this pair could become pioneers.
So to be clear, this animal is much later than the one we've been talking about from Utah. Yeah, but it could provide a link between big Tenontosaurus and little
these guys. Population, which eventually becomes a new species.
Yeah.
Unlike anything seen before.
Very nice. So yeah. They were so cute in Prehistoric Planet, weren't they? Those are what we call Rhabdodontian dinosaurs. Like Rhabdodon, like Zelmoxes, and etc. So anyway, this new dinosaur, Eoni, might help kind of bridge a gap there between some of these critters. Yeah. And so to give you some perspective here...
Nothing to do with oil. I'm a paleontologist.
And Jake Programming, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. Here's the Cretaceous period right here in the paper. And so this dinosaur is from up here in the lower Cenomanian. Where, there we go, Eoni smithi. I was digging way down here in the Berriasian at the beginning of the Cretaceous. So it's crazy how far the Cedar Mountain formation extends. It's basically the entire lower Cretaceous period of Utah. Really ought to break that thing up into multiple formations, but whatever. So yeah. And Reanimated Bit says, is there any evidence for dinosaurs trending towards becoming more social and forming larger family units over time? Maybe, roughly speaking? Most of the evidence that we have for dinosaur parental care comes from the Cretaceous period, like more than halfway through the age of dinosaurs. But that might just be because the lower part of the Mesozoic is fairly scanty. So I don't know. That's a good question. We do think dinosaurs would have been fairly social even early on. Like, we've got some evidence of dinosaur social behavior, like the fishing grounds at in St. George, Utah, at the dinosaur track site there. There's a bunch of dinosaurs all hanging out at the same time, same place. You know, we've got evidence for herding behavior in herbivorous dinosaurs from the early Jurassic period, too. So, I don't know. It's hard to say. We don't have that much information yet. So trying to decipher any kind of trend over the age of dinosaurs is really tricky, you know? We need more information before we can identify any trends with confidence. I guess that's the way I would answer that question. Thanks for asking. Yeah. Displacer says, do you just guess our questions and have videos ready to rock? I don't know what... could you rephrase that question, Displacer? I'm not sure I understand. Yeah. Like, I don't have a video ready to rock about this question. I don't understand it. Yeah. I don't know. What do you mean? And do I have a tree-sapped mosquito? I do not. Non-toxic. No. That one in Jurassic Park that you're thinking of? Yeah. You know, I'm sure you're thinking of this right here. from Jurassic Park. Like that. That was a prop. That wasn't real. Mosquitoes didn't really get that big, even during the Age of Dinosaurs. I think that's a crane fly that's in there, isn't it? Like that? Yeah, that's not even a mosquito. That's a crane fly, which is a totally unrelated group of insects. Yeah. But yeah, anywho. Yeah. And Displacer says, like, before stream, do you sit down and say, I'll bet I'll get these questions? I've been doing this since May of 2020, and I get a lot of the same questions. So for some things, I already have a video that I've used to answer a question before, so I'll just pull that back up. Like, most of the videos we've watched today have been things that, you know, that I've covered in the past. Yeah. And aren't they both Diptera? Diptera's a huge group, though, Meow House. Holy cow. Here, Meow House, let's take a look at that. Yeah. This is a tool that I like to use. This is a beautiful tree of life here. So just... by way of example, let's look up human beings on our tree of life, and it'll zoom into them. There we go. Yeah, good stuff. There's a space man. Chippermunk, thank you for the, A 12-month tier 1 sub to Chippermunk. Am I reading this correctly? Chippermunk, did you just get gifted 1 year of subscription to the channel? Anonymous gifter, you are as generous as you are mysterious. I appreciate you for it. You should be here as the representative of humanity on our tree of life. That's incredible. Holy cow. That's really good stuff. Yeah. Holy cow. Anyway, let's jump from Homo sapiens to... Diptera. True flies, mosquitoes, and gnats. That's going to be quite the journey to get to them. Gotta go outside of vertebrata and down into insects. And then Diptera. True flies, mosquitoes, and gnats. There's 160,909 species. That is a big group. Let's see if crane flies are included within that. Crane flies. They are. All right. Nice. Crane flies. And there's 4,266 species of them. But they're pretty far from mosquitoes, I think. Yeah. Culicidae. They are a good distance away. Holy cow. Crane flies and mosquitoes are not close at all. Holy cow. And there's 3,739 species, according to this count, of mosquitoes. Wow. Yeah. Cool stuff. Cool stuff. But yeah. Yeah. Anyway, 3,739 too many, says Displacer. Not a fan of mosquitoes? Man, I thought everybody loved mosquitoes, you know? Doesn't everybody love mosquitoes? What's not to love? yeah. It reminds me of a joke from Simpsons. Oh, boy. Yeah. What's not to love about mosquitoes? I thought everybody loved mosquitoes. I just don't get it, you know? Yeah.
And so, as the rat's milk is returned to the sewers, the circle of life is complete. Fat Tony, do you have any comment?
I don't get it. Everyone loves rats, but they don't want to drink the rat's milk.
And so...
It's one of my favorite Simpsons jokes ever. It's just, oh, it's so good. It's so good. Prehistoric fact. Thank you, Bertinch, for the follow. Bertinche. Welcome to Paleontologizing. I just don't get it. Everybody loves rats, but they don't want to drink the rat's milk? how did we get on this? I don't even remember. Shoot. Let's get back to our new Cedar Mountain Formation Speedo there. Small-bodied, early diverging ornithischian. Hang on a minute. There we go. Present. Good stuff. Only 35 species drink mammalian blood? I did not know that, Claire. Well. Interesting. Cool. Yeah. Oh, crane flies in Jurassic Park. There you go, recreational supplement. Here's some objects.
Gorgeous, gargantuans, and authentic. Because though they died out so long ago, their fossil bones remain. So we know just what they were like and can even sculpt them
from extinct, or rather extinct life. There you go. But yeah. Yeah. And Silent Kevin, I hope you're taking care of that poor inebriated roommate. Make sure they get some good rest and stay hydrated. Holy cow. Devin Versus, do you know the ghosts of the dinosaurs are still walking the earth? Yeah, and again, they look like this. There we go. Look at all those ghostly dinosaurs. And Hexku, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. Yes, indeed. Birds are living dinosaurs. So we don't even need dinosaur ghosts. We've got living dinosaurs around us every day, flying around all over the place. Soiling your patio furniture and eating out of your bird feeders. Good stuff. Hi, Ticket Attractions. How are you doing? Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's a spooky... Yeah, that's the first thing I think of when I think of birds, you know? Spooky. Wasn't that Emily Dickinson's poem about birds? What's that thing with feathers? Spooky, I guess. Yeah. Devin Versus, can you tell me something about Iguanodon? I can show you something about Iguanodon, Devin Verse. Yeah. And then maybe... It might be a pain in the butt to take down that Dilophosaurus skull. Non-toxic, but I can try. Let's see. Yeah. Here. Do you want to see something about Iguanodon there, Devin? Oh. Drucifer, thank you for the 12 months of support. That's some tasty stuff. Yeah. Good stuff. Thank you, Drucifer. Thank you, thank you. Oh, yeah. Here we go. You want to see some Iguanodon? Here is some Iguanodon. This is the hand of Iguanodon bernisartensis. That's a big animal. And... they've got really big hands. Here's the thumb spike right here. So, yeah, holy cow. Big critter. So this is my 3D printed Iguanodon hand. Of the largest species of Iguanodon that I know of. Yeah. Good stuff. But I was digging up a bunch of iguanodonts this summer. Not iguanodon proper from Europe, but a hopefully new species of iguanodont. When we were back in Utah, digging in the Cedar Mountain Formation, we had a whole bunch of different bones of this hopefully new iguanodont. And Gus, Seven Monkey, the firefighter, thank you, Gus, for the follow. Welcome, welcome. Yeah, so, you know, I drew that to help, like, advertise the stream. But yeah, we were digging up some, at least one new species of iguanodont, possibly more, in the earliest Cretaceous Cedar Mountain Formation of Utah. And you can see all of that on the YouTube page. Right here. Yeah. Let's try this here. Yeah, I was streaming all of this live.
They brought this big jacket back to the museum and they're prepping it.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm wearing the same shirt that I am right now.
The oldest in the world.
What a lovely graph there. A flying tombstone. Thanks for having us look. And welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Yeah. But yeah, anyway. We've got, hopefully, a couple new species of iguanodont right here. Jim thinks there's at least two, but further study will actually show what we've got. We'll see. We will see. Yeah, oh, and Smorf, you're here if we want to do Carithosaurus. Let's do a dinosaur deep dive in Carithosaurus real quick. How about? Yeah. But let's make it real fast. Because I've got so many more dinosaurs to cover. We might not get through all of them today. Because we've gotten... What, there's been... Hang on. We've gotten through two so far? Yeah, shoot. So we're only halfway through the month of June. We still have two more dinosaurs for June, and then four for July, and then one for August. Holy cow. We're not making great time. But we'll see. If it would be better tomorrow, I can wait. Actually, if you wouldn't mind, Smorf, let's do that then. Yeah. That'd be good. A three-hour tour. There you go, Clipper. You get shipwrecked here. But yeah. Yeah. We said this is a new Hypsilophodontian, right? Well, it's what we call a speedo nowadays. That's the term of art for these critters. Speedo for small-bodied, early diverging ornithischian. That is the term that we use for these critters. And you're asking for... Oh, yeah. For bingo card reasons, this would be a Hypsilophodont. You're right, Lenina. Yes. Yeah. Anyway, and wait, Ken, what are you talking? Sadist, what? Did I miss something? Anyway, let's get into our next dinosaur, described in June of this year. We've got a new armored dinosaur from across the pond, over on the Isle of Wight, Vectipelta barrettae. I assume named after Paul Barrett, right? Published on June 15th. It is from the Cretaceous period, Lower Boremian Age, so early Cretaceous, from the Isle of Wight in the UK. And this is interesting. This dinosaur was discovered twice. In November 1993 and March of 1994. So I will ask you, chat, Why would this dinosaur have been discovered twice? Consider that it is from the Isle of Wight in the UK. Anybody have any ideas? Why would it be discovered two times? If you know anything about the Isle of Wight, then maybe you'd have a clue about this. Yeah. Because they forgot about it. People are very, very forgetful on the Isle of Wight. Silent Kevin, famously. No. Here, I'll give you 31 more seconds of the Jeopardy music. Adult and juvenile says, so Spartan? Oh, good guess. Good guess. Thinking ontogenetically there. Mind erasing spell? I don't think that's Gimp Leg. That's the case, but we'll see. Construction delays? Getting close there, Pendrake. Renamed? An okay to play? That's sort of, but we'll get into why. Well, I'll just tell you the answer up front here before we look at the paper. The Isle of Wight has all of these cliffs right there on the beach where things fall down from the cliffs and then you find fossils in these rocks that have fallen down off the cliffs. So some fell down in November 1993 and were discovered by fossil hunters. And then again in March 1994, probably after a subsequent storm, more pieces of it were discovered by different collectors. Yeah. But I'm sure the paper will talk about that more in detail. It's an ankylosaur, but is it a nodosaur or a polycanthine? Let's look at the paper and find out. I'm sure Jim would have some opinions on this. But let's have ourselves a look. Vectipelta baritae, a new ankylosaurian dinosaur. From the Lower Cretaceous Wessex formation of the Isle of Wight, UK. Excellent. And again, published on June 15th, 2023. There we go. Yeah. Introduction. Let's see. Institutional abbreviations, photogrammetry, geological setting, discovery, excavation, and previous work. The specimen was found approximately 50 meters to the west of Chilton Chine, an area which forms part of the Compton Chine to Steeple Cove site of Isle of Wight. The Isle of Wight area of outstanding natural beauty. I'm glad it's protected like that, but that, man, does that sound kind of hoity-toity. An area of outstanding natural beauty. Here we go. Several vertebrae belonging to the specimen were collected from the beach in November 1993 by Gavin Leng, and he later donated them to the collections of the Dinosaur Isle Museum. The remainder of the skeleton was found by Lynn Spearpoint in March or April of 1994. In cliffs belonging to Richard Fisk. Richard Fisk gave permission for Lynn Spearpoint, Dick Spearpoint, and one of us from the MIS to excavate and acquire the specimen. Yeah. So it's not a particularly hospitable site because the ocean tide actually comes in here at certain times, so I guess they weren't able to make a proper quarry map? Yowza. Those of you who watched our fieldwork streams know how important a quarry map is. They weren't able to do that at this site. But, yeah. So these fossils were collected by multiple people as they were coming out, being eroded away by the ocean tides and stuff. So there are multiple discoverers of this animal, which is pretty cool. And take a look at that. These are such ridiculous animals. So this is the animal from the side. So this is kind of your fairly typical ankylosaur body plan. So those are the bones that we actually have from it. And there's the silhouette of what the animal would look like. But here it is from a top view. This is basically like a giant armored walking coffee table. These animals are like, they're wider than they are tall. It's such a ridiculous animal. It's super thick there, Youth Decay. Yeah, yeah. Thick with two C's. Maybe three C's even. And so with those armor spines along the sides, of which they actually have several preserved, this animal would be significantly wider than it is tall. Yeah. So picture you're And Nick Tonight, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Picture you're a voracious meat-eating dinosaur and you really want to eat this guy. Well, it's all armor up top, and these giant, formidable spikes, you'd have to flip them over in order to get to that biteable underbelly. But the animal is so low slung, and if it just crouches a bit, then... Well, shoot, you're gonna try and kick it over with these spines sticking out of the side like that? Oof. So yeah, pretty cool. And, pretty formidable animal. So yeah. And there are some of the vertebrae illustrated. It kind of goes on like that, yeah. So yeah. Very nice. And this paper is also open access. If you would like to read it. Oh, they even did some histo there of one of the spines, which is really cool. I am always excited when somebody takes the time to do a histological study, to actually cut open some of those elements, look at them under a thin section under a microscope, and figure out the growth and metabolism of the animal based on that. That's really, really cool. Yeah. Not worth the cost to try and eat. Agreed, Nick Tonight. That's probably what a lot of meat-eating dinosaurs would have thought, too, which is one of the reasons why these guys are probably so successful, is that they're just not worth eating. When you've got spines and armor like that, not worth the cost, you know? Why bother? Can't be asked. Yeah... Gimplex says, do you get jealous when erosion does all the hard work and the paleontologists just hang out down by the beach? Well, here, these weren't paleontologists who dug these up. These were, like, hobbyist collectors. It's really hobbyist collectors who are the heroes in Isle of Wight dinosaur paleontology. They find most of the good stuff. Paleontologists just swoop in and describe these things for the most part. It's, dedicated... amateurs, really passionate members of the general public who find most of these things on the Isle of Wight in the UK. Yeah. A lot like Mary Anning. There you go, Claire Burr. Yeah. Yeah. Youth Decay says there's not much else to do in the Isle of Wight. Well, I'm sure there's plenty to do in the age of the internet. You could watch Paleontologizing. But yeah. Who sometimes do an oopsie. Well, everybody does. You know how it works, Nick. Yeah. Anyway, lovely paper here, lots of good figures, and it really looks like, these don't look like photographs, it looks like they scanned these elements, which is super cool. I betcha these are actually available as scans. This is becoming the new standard in vertebrate paleontology, especially for dinosaurs, scanning elements like this, so that if somebody needs to study them, they don't necessarily have to hop on a plane and travel across the world to do it. You could just send them the files. And then, maybe they can even 3D print them, like we're doing here with our Allosaurus skull. Yeah, that's pretty exciting stuff. It really is. So yeah, it's the future. Wave of the future, 6 foot turkey. Yeah. What do they scan them with? With a scanner, Pendrake. A 3D scanner. So yeah, very cool. And, so welcome to the world. Vectipelta. What a cool new dinosaur. It's neat that we've got a new ankylosaur from the UK, the first one to be published in like 100 years, I think. Pretty awesome. Yeah. Anyway. Next up, I think we'll just do two more of these And then we'll save the rest for tomorrow, maybe. Or maybe one more of these. We have another dinosaur by the name of Gonkoken. I love that so many of these new dinosaurs from this summer have got fairly unconventional names. This one's called Gonkoken Nanoi. And remember when we were talking about non-hadrosaurid hadrosauroids? This is what we're talking about here. Published on June 16th of this year. This would have been while I was out in Wyoming doing field work, digging up several new species of dinosaur, including a new hadrosauroid. This animal was published. Gonkoken. It's from the Cretaceous, the Lower Maastrichtian, from Chilean Patagonia. So it's of a growing list of Chilean dinosaurs, which is super exciting. And it's from almost the very end of the Age of Dinosaurs here. And this is, it's not a hadrosaurine, this is a non-hadrosaurid hadrosauroid. So we'll talk about what that means, Claire. Yeah. And ignore the stripes. This is just artistic representation here. We don't know if it had stripes, you know? This is just a way to make it more interesting. Dinosaurs were likely brightly colored and had all kinds of cool coloration and stuff, but we don't know this for sure for this animal. Yeah. Okay, two places. Did it reach up maybe on its hind legs to feed? It likely did. Yeah, other members of this group probably did too. So multiple specimens of this animal were discovered in 2013. Some of you might go, well, shoot, that's a long time until this was published, but that's actually about typical. 10 years might be about typical between the discovery of a new dinosaur and when it actually gets published in the scientific literature. Because it takes a long time to dig them up, a long time to clean them, a long time to reposit them into a museum and to properly study them and photograph them and write them up and then get them submitted to a journal and then work things out with your co-authors and revise it, put it through peer review, all that stuff. 10 years is about typical between when a dinosaur is first dug up and when it gets finally described. And Lena says, non-hadrosaurine hadrosaurid? No, it's not even a hadrosaurid, it's a hadrosauroid. We'll talk about what that means in a minute. Yeah. Drix Alex says, are dinosaur nuggets real dinosaurs? Well, I mean, they literally are. They're made from chicken. And as we've talked about many times, chickens are birds, and birds are a kind of dinosaur. So chicken nuggets are literally made out of literal dinosaurs. No kidding. Yeah. Smorph, do you have a dinosaur chicken emote? That's really cool. I like that, Smorph. I like that a lot. Copy current address. Anyway. Yeah, very cool, Smorph. I like that a lot. Anywho. Back to here. Gonkoken. Like I said, this is one of these new dinosaurs from this summer with a fairly unconventional name. It's not Latin-derived. It's from another language, and we'll talk about that. But it was identified as a non-hadrosaurid hadrosauroid. So this is from the general group of duckbill dinosaurs, but it's not a true hadrosaurid. So it's a... They're saying it's a fairly primitive member of this group that's late surviving, and we'll... Oh boy, this is going to be difficult to explain, but we'll try and get into it when we get into the paper. It's a late surviving member of its group, and I do believe I have the paper here. So let's take a look at that. Here we go. Gonkoken. Relict duck-billed dinosaur survived into the last age of the dinosaurs in sub-Antarctic Chile. What? That's actually a really exciting title. I like that a lot. So back then, Chile was way down south, within the Antarctic Circle, I suppose. And, oh boy, this just gives me chills the way that the abstract is written here. In the dusk of the Mesozoic, advanced duck-billed dinosaurs, Hadrosauridae, were so successful that they likely outcompeted other herbivores, contributing to declines in dinosaur diversity. That's interesting. Okay. From Laurasia, which is North America, Europe, and Asia, hadrosaurids, so like advanced duck-billed dinosaurs, dispersed widely, colonizing Africa, South America, and allegedly Antarctica. Here we present the first species of a duck-billed dinosaur from a sub-Antarctic region, Gonkogen nanoi, of early Maastrichtian age in Magallanes, Chile. Unlike duckbills further north in Patagonia, Gonkogen descends from North American forms diverging shortly before the origin of Hadrosauridae. Over at this time, non-hadrosaurids in North America had become replaced by hadrosaurids. And Lawrence 6060, thanks for that follow. Welcome, welcome. We propose that the ancestors of Gonkogen arrived earlier in South America and reached further south into regions where hadrosaurids never arrived. All alleged sub-Antarctic and Antarctic remains of hadrosaurids could belong to non-hadrosaurid duckbills like Gonkogen. Dinosaur faunas of the world underwent qualitatively different changes before the Cretaceous-Paleogene asteroid impact, which should be considered when discussing their possible vulnerability. That's interesting. I wonder what they're going to have to say about that. Again, in a high-profile paper like this, in a journal like Science Advances, you're going to want to have some wider-reaching implications, and you might reach a bit for those. Let's see if they do that here. But there we go. And shoot, this is from way down south in Chile. I was not expecting that. Very cool. And it's from about, 70.5 plus or minus 5 million years ago. So they don't have a firm date on this. It could be 66 million years old. It could be 75 million years old. Oh boy. We need better dates on that, but I'm sure they're doing the best they can. And this down here, 71.7 plus or minus 1.2. Oh, no, shoot. Okay, I get this. So this dinosaur is... it's no older than 71 million years old. Maybe 72. But it's no younger than 70.5. So, okay, I see how they dated it. They basically have a bracket here. It's definitely older than this, 70.5, plus or minus 5 million years. And it's definitely younger than 71.7, plus or minus 1.2 million years. Okay, interesting. Yeah, some razzle-dazzle. There you go, Ken, yeah. They've definitely got some razzle-dazzle in this paper. This is nice. Yeah. So, about the etymology of this animal. Where did that name, Gonkogen, come from? The words gon, same as similar to, and koken, wild duck or swan, are in the language of the Ayonkinenk, the indigenous people that inhabited the region where this species was found. The specific name, Nanoi, is in reference to Mario Nano Ulloa, who first found dinosaur bones at the Rio de las Chinas Valley and provided key logistic help during our expeditions. Very cool. So this guy was helping out while they were digging up this dinosaur, and they named it after him as a thank you, which is pretty cool. Imagine... TN8R, STFC, thank you for the follow. Welcome. Imagine helping out with a dinosaur expedition like this and then getting a dinosaur named after you. What a tremendous honor. That's super cool. Yeah. So this is a small-sized hadrosauroid dinosaur, body length of about 4 meters. So this critter's like less than 13 feet long when full grown, I guess. Not huge. And it's got several primitive characteristics they outline here that show that it's probably not a true hadrosaur. That's really interesting.
Did you ever, though, have a moment where it was kind of heartbreaking? Destroying? Never.
No, glue is cheap.
SysAdmin, thank you for the 2 months of support. I appreciate that very much. And welcome back. Yeah. Anyway, very cool. It's nice that they've got a decent amount of this animal, including some important skull bones there.
You're not doing so badly, are
Well, thank you, our Miss Colored, and welcome to Paleontologizing. Thank you for that compliment and that follow. Yeah. And there's some of the illustrated bones there. We've got a nice humerus, nice ilium, really nice dentary right here with the ascending process, articulating with the upper jaws. Very cool. Very nice scapula right there, shoulder blades, vertebrae. Lovely, lovely. And they're saying on the family tree, computer says it comes out next to Eotrachodon and Huehuecanotlus. That's interesting. So yeah, basal to Hadrosauridae, not a true hadrosaurid, but part of Hadrosauroidea. Very nice. And then we've got some different hypotheses as to how this animal came down here. Very cool. Ancestors came down from North America and then made it this far south. I guess they're proposing in this paper that true hadrosaurids didn't actually make it this far. Oh, there we go. They didn't actually make it this far south, which is an interesting idea. Yeah. Blame Paul Sereno. Wait, what was that, Kim? I missed something? Yeah. SG Rock says, how many bones are required to name a new species? Wait, hang on. Oh, shoot. We were using the wrong view there. Wrong scene. It depends. I mean, there's no, like, official requirement. That's the thing among dinosaur paleontologists, is that you can try and name something based on a fragment of a single tooth, but it probably won't be what we call diagnostic. Like, it won't be a very useful diagnosis for figuring out if another dinosaur that somebody describes is the same thing or not. Ideally, you want the majority of a skeleton, so you have the highest likelihood that someone will be able to, you know, if they find other parts of what might be the same animal, you'll have some overlap. Maybe the shoulder blade is the same. Maybe you've got a vertebral column between both of them or something. Or better yet, bits of skull that you can compare between them. But yeah, yeah. A lot of new terminology in phylogeny. Oh, that's true, Ken. Yeah, Paul Sereno did come up with a bunch of those terms. He loves inventing new terms. Some of them very useful for dinosaur phylogeny. Yeah. And Hazanku says, well, they were pretty equivalent everywhere they went, right? So not a wild assumption? What do you mean, Hazanku? Can you elaborate? I'm not sure I follow. They were pretty equivalent everywhere they went? Who are you talking about? Yeah. Let me know. I'm sure you're right. But yeah. Pendrake says there should really be some sort of taxonomical standard. We don't have enough material to make a standard like that, you know? Yeah. The thing is, for most of these animals, they're not known from complete material. And so, like, this animal right here, we can tell it's a hadrosaur, a hadrosauroid, but it doesn't appear to be a hadrosaurid. So it's like a really primitive, to use kind of a weasel word, duck-bill dinosaur. Does that make sense? I don't know. So yeah. Anywho. And prevalent, the hadrosaurs. Yeah, hadrosaurs were pretty prevalent. They lived on almost every continent. Your duck-billed dinosaurs, hadrosaurs. Hadrosauridae. Your various duck-billed dinosaurs lived in North America, South America, like we see in this new paper. They lived in Asia. They lived in Europe. They may or may not have lived in Australia, I'm not sure, and Antarctica also. We know they lived in Africa, though, so potentially all seven continents. For sure, we know they're in North and South America, Europe, Asia, Africa, maybe also the sixth and seventh continents, Australia, and Antarctica. But fossils are pretty rare from there, of dinosaurs, so we don't have a lot of evidence yet. But yeah, yeah. And not toxic. Somebody type in exclamation mark necklace, because I have a command about this. This is sentimental, yeah. But that Z coal in there from the extinction of the dinosaurs. Yeah. Smay says, you said that dinosaurs were creating new species all the time, evolving all the time, yeah, in a new species. Is that true for mammals or fish, etc.? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That's the thing, is that evolution is constantly occurring. If a species is not evolving, then that means it's extinct. You can't stop evolution, you know? It's always progressing, because children are always a little bit different from their parents. And that's essentially what evolution is. One generation is a little bit different from the one before it, a little bit different from the one before it. Living things are not static. They change over time. And under periods of ecological stress, those changes are driven by changing conditions in the environment. So during really, really good times, you know, everybody can survive and prosper, but when times get really, really tough, sometimes you need a thicker beak to survive in order to crack nuts open or something. Maybe you need longer legs for running or something like that. So it's like when conditions change, that's sometimes when you have morphological evolution that happens a little bit faster, because you have a smaller population, you get a bottleneck, and only like certain members of the population survive, and then they're later able to spread out and have more offspring when conditions get better. But if the conditions don't get better, then they just go extinct, you know? So yeah, that's the history of life on Earth. Does that make sense? Yeah. Grossly oversimplifying here, but that's the long and short of it. Mostly the short of it. But yeah. And hadrosauroids are outside that. This is true, Ken, yeah. Yeah. So I wonder if this shows that. So hadrosauroidea, yeah, there we go. So our new dinosaur, Gonkoken, would be branching off of here. So it's outside of this clade. It's like an early branching side group. And thank you, Simone Silvana, for the follow. Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. Yeah. And did humans have those bottlenecks? We definitely did, SV Harkin, yeah. That's one of the reasons why humans are so genetically undiverse. Like, we're very, very similar to everyone else on it. Like, human beings had a big genetic bottleneck. And it may have been due to, like, a big volcanic eruption that happened, I think, in Indonesia, back when we, shortly after we'd split off from our ancestors. But yeah, there is, like, less genetic diversity in people around the world than there is in, like, just one troop of chimpanzees, is what I've read. It's like one troop of chimpanzees who all hang out together and, you know, do their chimpanzee things together. They're more genetically different from each other in one small group than all of humanity is from each other. Does that make sense? Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. So really, human beings, we're pretty uniform, honestly. Some of us might look a little bit different from others, but like genetically, we're all very, very similar. There really is just like one human race. At least when you compare us to other species on Earth, there's a lot more genetic diversity in other species than there is among humans. Yeah. And Displacer says, what's the evolutionary purpose of the horn on the hadrosaur? Oh, you're talking about Parasaurolophus here? You're talking about these guys in the chat? Talking about this? We don't really call it a horn usually. The term of art that we have for this is a crest. And a lot of these Lambiosaurinae, they've got these crazy crests, like on this guy, and Lambiosaurus proper. It's got a pretty crazy crest on it, too. These seem to have been resonating chambers. Honkers, says 6 foot turkey. Sure. Yeah. Yeah, let me see if I can find that clip. I think it's in here with Dave Y sample, right? There we go. And there's, of course, Bob Bakker, because it's the 90s.
Hollow crest. He looked at it and said, it looks like a trombone. It was a trombone. It was for making loud courtship noises.
David Weishempel wondered what the 70-million-year-old love song of the Parasaurolophus sounded like. He knew that when the animal exhaled, yep, the air would shoot up the windpipe to the back of the crest into the throat and out the snout.
There you go.
Sample built himself a horn as long as the crest and taught himself to play it.
Well, this contraption that I've got in my hands here is, in fact, a model of the crest of Parasaurolophus.
Yep.
It's the right size and the right shape for Parasaurolophus. It's built out of PVC tubing. And the reason I built it was to get a better sense as to the kinds of sound that Parasaurolophus would have made. So why don't I play it for you?
That's pretty cool.
This unique love song no doubt made the Parasaurolophus the diva of the dinosaurs.
Sure, whatever. I love those old clips, but yeah, that seems to be what the purpose is for the various crests of Lambiosaurine dinosaurs. Be it Parasaurolophus, be it Corythosaurus, or this looks more like Hypacrosaurus. Maybe Allura Titan there. Yeah.
I think dinosaurs are put together correctly, the bones. You're smart. Fair what do you question. Think?
Do a research on that, Oliver.
I'd never.
And. Why is that a thing? LP, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Yeah. So yeah. And try to print a proper hydro saxophone, Hazanku. Yeah, it's cool. There's actually somebody on YouTube who did that. Was it YouTube or was it? I think it was Twitter. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to find it on here. But there was like, I think a graduate student who was studying the acoustics of hadrosaur crests. Shoot, I'm not finding it on here. But I saw it on Twitter back when Twitter was a thing. But anyway. Really cool dinosaur here. Goncoquen. New dinosaur from Chile. Got some beautiful material from it. And it's pretty exciting stuff. It really is. I'm really glad to have this critter. And... if you'd like to read the original paper, I betcha you can find it right here on the Wikipedia page. There it is. Open access. Don't we love it? Yeah. Good stuff. Excellent. And that wraps up our June dinosaurs here. There we go. There we are. And with that, we're ready for July and August. However, I've been streaming now for 3 hours and 47 minutes. It might make sense to wrap up today's stream and just do the rest of those tomorrow. So I think we'll probably do that. But how do you like the new presentation style here? Does this actually add anything, or is it just kind of obnoxious? Let me know. You like it, Claire? All right. Cool. It's, this is fun like this. I do like it. And looks cool, Mark Melbourne? Excellent. I'm glad to hear it. All right. And 9 new dinosaurs found this summer? Exactly, Ox Kirby. Yeah. 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 I might use this for future stuff then. So I'm glad you like it, everybody. Yeah. New and changing it up is good, says Pendrake. Good. I'm glad. Yeah. Well, very cool. Well, well, well. With that being said, I think it's about time for us to start wrapping this thing up. Because I've actually got some science work that I've got to do this evening. Our 3D print should be done in a little bit. We'll assemble this tomorrow on our Allosaurus skull. But for right now, let's go ahead and wrap up our stream here. And there's good old Archaeopteryx there in the background as we do this. Let's see who else is live on Twitch right now. Let's see. Let's go say hello to Melissa in Denial, why don't we? Excellent. Yeah. Thank you to everybody whose names are showing up here in the credits. Thank you to everybody who tuned in today. Thank you for your fellowship, your views, your attention, your enthusiasm, your questions, and maybe most importantly of all, your financial support. Thank you very much for helping keep me here on the air. We blew away our sub goal today. 69 out of 60 new subs. Nice. And join us again tomorrow to go over the rest of our dinosaurs that were published this summer. We've got 5 more of them.
If you're feeling a bit cheated,
I'm excited to share them with you. Thank you, Mr. Poolshot, for those 100 bits. That's lovely. It really is. Good stuff. Anyway, I'll see you tomorrow, everybody. Thank you again, and let's go see what Melissa in Denial, archaeologist and Egyptologist, is up to. I'll see you there, everybody. Take care.